Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have apologies this morning from John Mason. The first item on our agenda is a roundtable discussion on managing Scotland's public finances, a strategic approach. I would like to welcome to the meeting Alan Falls, Senior Policy Officer, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, known as the Alliance. Alice Telford, Head of Business Policy and Public Sector at the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland. Ewan Lockhead, Architect, Retrofit Coordinator, North East Scotland Retrofit Hub. Lewis Ryder-Jones, Advocacy Officer, Oxfam Scotland. Michael Kellett, Director of Strategy, Governance and Performance, Public Health Scotland. David Mellish, Director, Scottish Property Federation. And Heather Williams, Training Lead, Scottish Women's Budget Group, Women's Economic Empowerment Project. Unfortunately, Dave Moxham, Deputy General Secretary of the Scottish Trade Union Congress, who was due to participate, is no longer able to attend. I'd like to thank all of you for your written submissions, which has given me a very enjoyable Saturday and Sunday reading them. We have around 90 minutes for this session. If witnesses would like to be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to the clerks and they can then call you. So it's not a situation whereby I'm just going to ask various questions of individuals. What I'm hoping for is a kind of, as it says on the tin, a roundtable discussion. So basically, I'll ask my first question, which will be to Alan Falls. He already knows I'm going to be asking him the first question. And then anyone who wants to come in on the back of that question, just let me know and I'll just take people as I see, and hopefully we'll get quite an informed discussion. I will, if things start getting stuck, move things on. So we'll go from effectively taxation and growing the tax base to public service reform, potential behavioural response and capital expenditure, just as it kind of says on the kind of tin. And I will try and involve every single person who has given a submission as often as possible, really, as often as you wish to come in. Okay then, so I think the first thing to do then is, in reference to your submission, Alan, what you basically said is, when we asked the first question about the Scottish Government and its priorities, you said that you are quite happy with the Scottish Government's priorities, such as eradicating child poverty, tackling a climate emergency and improving public services. But you say believing the priority of growing the economy represents a step backwards in the Scottish Government's approach to the economy. Now, given your submission and your reference to increasing public expenditure in a number of areas, I'm just wondering how you can kind of square that circle.
Yeah, so I suppose it's not that the Alliance is sort of opposed to economic growth, certainly not. It's more that the Scottish Government's focus has moved away. I think in the previous cabinet had been the discussion around the wellbeing economy. So it was a lot of discussion around economic growth for a purpose. So growing the economy to, you know, grow the tax base, but also to invest in public services. And we are just slightly concerned that some of the formulation of the government strategy under the new cabinet is very much along the lines of just sort of a more sort of traditional view of just growing the economy almost for growth's sake, which we're not necessarily particularly comfortable with. Obviously, we do recognise that at the moment it is quite straitened financial times, but we would be suggesting that in addition to that simple sort of growth mindset, we'd also be keen to see that the Scottish Government consider effectively a human rights-based approach to public finances, recognising that there are certain things, for example, high-quality social care, that we should be providing to people as a basis of a fundamental human right, so they can engage properly in society and the wider economy, and that we should therefore be considering things like our tax base with a view to how we deliver that, rather than simply looking at it purely through the economic lens. And I think one of the other points I made is, if we're talking about investment in, for example, social security, that contributes to economic growth, because people on low incomes are by definition not spending money on essentials, they're not spending money on leisure and hospitality and so on, whereas if they did have a bit more income from social security, that just goes straight back into the economy, it goes into local shops and businesses and leisure, so it shouldn't be seen as in tension with the economy, growing the economy, if that makes sense.
Yes, it does. I mean, there's issues, of course, about the fact that the Scottish budget is more or less fixed, and there's been concerns raised that the fact that in Scotland there's almost £1 billion more paid out in Social Security than if we just retained UK Social Security levels, and that £1 billion effectively has to come out of other areas of the Scottish budget. One of the things you've also said is that you want to make use of national level taxes, including income tax, to the fullest extent possible. Now, this morning, Mary Spowage, who's a budget advisor at this committee, I have to say, said on behalf of the Fraser Valens Institute that the taxation level that Scotland already has is actually the perception more than the reality, I believe. But the perception is actually potentially deterring investment, and that one in six businesses has actually argued that. So what's your view on that? I mean, would that not be counterproductive? Just one other thing I'll say on that before widening it out. The evidence we took last week, for example, from Professor Heald, eminent economist, Glasgow University, referred to the Scottish Fiscal Commission, that said that last year when we increased the top rate of tax, there was an 85% behavioural impact, which is something I'll go on to further in the discussion. So how do you feel we can get the balance right on this?
So I suppose that admittedly a difficult question, and the Alliance is not a sort of a tax specialist organisation. I was kind of aware that we had a discussion quite recently with the Cabinet Secretary that also included the IPPR, and they were of the view that some of these behavioural changes can in fact be somewhat exaggerated. They're not necessarily felt to the extent on the ground once things are brought in as modelling suggests that they might be. I suppose that obviously we did talk about that national level taxation, but there is a role there for local level taxation as well, when you consider that last year obviously part of the national budget went into a council tax freeze, and I think there was quite a sort of uniformity across large sectors of sections of the third sector, across local government itself and academics, including I think the Fraser Valander Institute, that didn't necessarily represent a good investment of public funds was that council tax freeze, and effectively that sort of put, yes, it was funded, but it's put more restrictions on local government funding. And the point we've sort of repeatedly made is that if there was a bit more progress on local government taxation, and I'll do the thing I always do, which is say I was less than a year old when council tax valuations were introduced, I'm now 34, if there was a bit more movement on local taxation, so we improved that local tax base and particularly improved the ability to more accurately tax wealth, particularly in the form of property wealth, that's what council tax is very bad at by this point, that would free up a bit more flexibility in the national level because you'd have a slightly stronger local tax base.
Okay, Lewis, is the only one who's signalled he wants to come in so far. I'm hoping some of you will be a bit more enthusiastic as we progress. Lewis, you've said that growing the economy can't be a legitimate priority without important caveats, and you've also said that Scotland's income tax system can and must do much more, and we must be even more bolder on income tax. You've obviously referred to council tax as well, but I'm just wondering if you can take up the cudgels.
Sure, thank you. Great to be here this morning. Thanks for inviting me. I mean, a lot of what I'm about to say echoes what Alan's just said, and I'll so fully agree with the points made about growing the economy. And on that, our position at Oxfam is that growth for growth's sake does not lead to long-term societal positive outcomes. We need, at this point more than ever before, to shift our perception of what type of growth matters and how it's distributed. We use GDP as the measure to decide whether or not growth is good or bad, yet we know nothing about how that growth is distributed through that measure. We have, and this committee is looking at the national outcomes right now as part of the scrutiny of the new set that will be set for the next 5 years, a really rich set of measures in Scotland, and it's about to become even richer. We need to see those measures taking priority, GDP relegated beneath them, to understand how growth is impacting different parts of the economy. From Oxfam's perspective, much like what Alan said, the care economy is vital. We need to see growth there. Not just because of the long-term implications of population ageing, but also because it will have a positive impact on our poverty rates and on gender inequality. The climate crisis is facing us at a level that we just are not ready for. What's happening in Central Europe right now is a case in point. We need to see investment at a scale we have not seen in renewables, and we do need growth in those sectors, absolutely, there is no doubt about that. But the way we measure growth, the way that the Wellbeing Economy Monitor measures growth, is still very limited. So that's really our main point on the economy. When it comes to tax, we have said, and we agree with others on this, that we haven't finished what we can do on income tax. We understand the perceptions that you mentioned around discouraging investment, but We believe that's partly because if we our starting point is the existing income tax system and you are tweaking the upper rates, rather than going back to the drawing board and thinking how can we build an income tax system that is perceived to be fair from the ground up, which is within the gift of the Scottish Parliament to do, then we're always going to feel this pushback. We're not saying necessarily that income tax rates for middle income earners needs to increase. In fact, you know, we're pretty clear that they probably don't at this point. The tax burden needs to shift towards those with higher incomes, no doubt. Second point on growing the tax base, we fully agree that local taxation is completely not fit for purpose. But going beyond council tax, we also think the system of business rates is vital. And that system could do much more to encourage fair work. It could do much more to encourage some of the voluntary accreditation schemes like Carers Positive example. We could use more stick along with the carrot to allow businesses to do more for their employees, which ultimately would have a long-term impact on economic growth in this country.
Okay, David, to be followed by Alice.
So I was just going to come in on that. I mean, I think from our perspective, we've had nigh on since the financial crash, pretty much a flatlining economy. I think the no growth scenario has been tried, and unfortunately we're in a position now where the lack of economic growth and the pressure, the lack of revenues, is now undermining those other elements, which I think colleagues have referred to earlier. I mean, I think I'm right in saying that income from, for example, ScotWind has been diverted towards the emergency sort of budget measures that we've seen recently. So that's taking away, you know, significant potential for investment in retrofit renewables and so on. And I think our standing point is that unless we get growth in the economy, you will not increase the public revenues to be able to invest in those things which have been referred to earlier. So my fear is that we are in that tricky, vicious circle of low growth, increasing demands from public and from government and society at large, and yes, actually, some really big needs for investment in infrastructure that is going to lead us towards, for example, the agenda of net zero and so on. So I think we're in a position where we have to get the economy primed and moving ahead at more than zero or flatlining rates, and I think that for us has to be our priority for the Parliament in the position it really is right now. So that's not economic growth for the sake of just seeing 2 or 3% on the GDP measure. It's growth for a purpose, and I think that's where we need to be at the moment.
Alison, followed by Michael Mara.
So it's good to have a proportionate tax system in place. We do note that there is a heavy reliance on the 10% of the higher taxpayers. And our understanding it's around 65% of the revenue from there. We note the comment by the Scottish Fiscal Commission on the behavioural impact and the figure they've put against it. So it's very difficult to get a figure. Sometimes it's some almost conjecture, because a lot of the activities that may be involved may not be visible. So, for example, you might pay more into a pension scheme or refuse to take extra hours, and you may even choose to retire. So there is a risk that's recognised, and a way of a potential approach is to sort of diversify from that risk, which includes perhaps looking across the spectrum of the tax bases, includes growing the economy, making Scotland an attractive inward destination, providing that sort of stability and certainty to give business confidence to invest.
Okay, thank you. Michael Maris, before by Heather.
Yeah, it's on this area of the what we should do in the tax area, convener, both Lewis and Alan, I think, have touched on that. I mean, Lewis, you said that we haven't reached the limits of where we should go on some of these tax issues yet, but, you know, we're a situation where the Scottish Fiscal Commissioner tells us we're looking at around about 90% behavioural effects in terms of the top rate of tax. So, you know, reduction from, I think it was around about 90 million off the top of my head, down to £8 million of a benefit to the finance secretary in terms of the budget that's available to spend. I don't see where we go in that area to try and realise more of it. And you mentioned that around the middle income and trying to increase some of that. We know that most of that the money that's been raised in recent years has come from those middle income earners because of fiscal drag, people being pulled into the upper tax brackets. But those are people earning between £40,000 and £50,000 who, at the moment, I just don't feel like, they don't feel rich, far from it. You know, the prices are increasing, and I think you recognise that. So this is something that the committee wrestles with in terms of trying to understand where we might realise more of that money. I mean, is it possible to set out a little bit more about how you think that is possible?
Respond to that. I mean, given it's directed at you.
Sure. Thanks. Yeah, I recognise that too. I do. I think when it comes to the perception of it being bad for the economy and the potential behaviour change, let's be clear, as Alan said, this is potential, this is conjecture, and it's not necessarily going to come to pass. So that's the first thing. We need to make sure that Scotland is the sort of place that people want to live in. I mean, if you look at the tax burden in other European countries, the UK's tax burden, particularly with income tax, isn't even particularly high comparatively, but the disposable income within other European countries is much, much higher. And that has proven to stimulate economic growth. I mean, the Scottish Government's own ex-advisor, Joseph Stiglitz, has said on an array of occasions that reducing economic inequality globally and within countries is a vital part of sustainable economic growth. So I think we need to be making that case more, that by having a higher tax burden, it is an investment, not a burden, and therefore building a case for the public services and investment in Scotland that those taxes allow to create the context for people to say, ah, okay, yeah, I want to live here, even if my taxes are higher than they are down south. That's our challenge. If we run away from that argument, then we're not going to be in a position to ever win the argument. In terms of the specifics on what we can do on tax, there are various bits of research done in recent times on adjustments to a small degree within the higher advanced and rates and also the new rate that was introduced last year that would create some fiscal flexibility. I recognise, though, in my original answer, that those tweaks are not what's required to really enable the kind of public spending that our public services need. We need to see rethinking from the ground up. That might take two budgets to implement, but it's worth doing.
Indeed. Heather, to be followed by Michael Kellett.
Thank you. Following on from Lewis's point around behaviour change, in terms of the theory around that, it based on economic theory, is based on the idea that we're all just purely rational beings who are driven by money. And that's not the case. And one of the things that we would be saying is actually we need to look at things like human resource theory as well, which tells us that actually people aren't purely driven by money. We're not purely driven by wages in terms of the jobs that we choose and the work that we do, that there's lots more that informs the choices that we make as individuals. And I think that's something that we need to remember. And as Lewis was saying, that in terms of Scotland, we have lots to offer. Okay, the taxation may be higher, but actually what we get in return for that taxation is greater in terms of the country that we live in and what we're trying to create as a better proposition. And we need to be taking that into account as well. I think as well, when we think about behaviour change, we also need to be thinking about actually if we're going to grow the economy, we have to have a healthy population to have a healthy economy. And we have to have a population who are freed up and able to work. And that means considering our social infrastructure, so things like our social care, but also our childcare. Childcare and the cost of childcare is a massive disincentive for families to work, or in particularly for women in terms of the economic impact that has. So when we talk about behaviour change, we can't just think about taxation. We also have to think about the impact of that lack of social infrastructure how that impacts on different groups within society as well. And investing in our social infrastructure brings about that that base that allows us to grow our economy, because without that, what we have is we have stagnation.
I think I'm going to just merge behavioural change with this taxation section, because everyone's going on to it, and of course I kicked it off myself, so only myself to blame. Michael Kellett, before by Liz.
Convener, we're a public body, convener, as you know, in Public Health Scotland, and we don't have a position on taxation, but the economy theme is one that is really important in building on what Heather just said. One of the things I wanted to contribute is about this symbiotic relationship between health and the economy. We know from evidence that good jobs are really important to the health of individuals and to the community. We also know on the flip side that a healthy population is really important to a strong economy. We've been doing some work in Public Health Scotland with partners around how we tackle some of these issues, in particular how we tackle the large number of economically inactive people in Scotland. We think the latest figure is somewhere around 825,000 people are economically inactive. Of them, a third, 32%, are economically inactive because of ill health, and that's something we need to think about. The only other thing, convener, I wanted to say is that what's really important from our perspective, and might say more about this later, is using the revenue that's garnered from taxation and other revenue to invest more deliberately in prevention and getting upstream. We know in Scotland we have a poor pattern of public health, we have reducing healthy life expectancy, and we have increasing inequalities, and we need to focus on them in terms of improving the well-being of the population as a whole. Thanks, Kabir.
I'm going to come to that as we move on. Liz, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you. It's really a question to our panellists, and building on what both Heather and Michael have just said about economic inactivity, because one of the very considerable concerns that we have in Scotland are the numbers of people who are economically inactive, partly for health reasons, but also there's lots of people who do not have health reasons but who are not persuaded back into the labour force. Now, Heather's mentioned about childcare improvements in that. I'd just be interested to know if panellists have any suggestions about what else we have to do to persuade more people to come back into the workforce.
Okay. Michelle, and then I'll let you in again, Heather.
It's actually a slightly different theme, so I don't know if you want
to respond to that, and then I'll let you and Michelle.
So, thank you. In terms of our submission, we, the Women's Economic Empowerment Project is a joint project between ourselves, Glasgow Disability Alliance and the Women in Multiple Low-Paid Employment. And one of the things that that the group were saying, that if we want to grow the economy, we really need to look at the support that's available to disabled people to be able to support them into the workplace. Many want to work, but those social and systemic barriers that we have in society, but also in terms of employer attitudes and employer behaviours, are problematic, and that stops us being able to, disabled people being able to enter the workplace. I think there's also, particularly for women, one of the issues that we have is the way in which social security system works, so conditionality in relation to universal credit, and how that has been increasing, which previously, I think it's up to, it's slowly increasing the number of hours that you have to work to be classed as being in employment, and the disincentive that has, particularly in some of our more rural areas where there are issues in relation to childcare. So it's that thing where these things can create a perfect storm where it becomes very difficult for individuals to move into to work, particularly when we see councils making changes to things like out-of-hours care, because it's not a statutory responsibility, and therefore they're cutting those things, which then makes it nigh on impossible for individuals to continue to work or to actually get good good work in the first place.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Lewis wanted to come in just on this. Just hang on another wee minute, Michelle.
Thank you. Agree with everything that Heather just said, and just one additional point on the terminology. Really, we talk often about employability, but if we sort of step back from how that's intended to mean, it's the idea that people have to come to the labour market, not the other way around. And the most vulnerable people, whether those households with a disabled person, houses with unpaid carers, households that are run by single parents, mostly women. Often the problem is the jobs, not the desire to work. If we can switch our understanding of what employability is designed to do, providing that tailored support, there was lots of good work from Fair Start that sadly the budget's been stripped back. That if we can reinstate some of that, increase the level of tailored approach to these different high-risk groups, then that can make a massive difference to bringing the labour market closer to the individuals that need it most.
Okay, Michelle, to follow by Alan.
I just wanted to get a flavour from some of the attendees, because we've been focusing quite a lot on revenue rather than capital. I noticed...
We're coming on to it. Right, okay.
This is my question, right. Convener. Thank you.
Bother having a structure then, we'll just, you know... on you go.
Right, carrying on. I think it's important that we sort of disaggregate those, and I noticed the Scottish Property Federation, David, you yourself had commented in a quote, particular concern regarding reduction in capital investment, and I think ICAS probably have a view on that as well. And I suppose my question is, in the light of an anticipated 20% reduction to the Scottish Government's capital budget over the next 5 years, which is significant when you understand what capital can do for an economy, have you got anything to add to that? Because it does represent real challenges for the Scottish Government. And a wee throwaway comment I picked up in terms of the Property Federation's submission in terms of 54% decline in construction activity from July 2023 to 2024, which seems utterly staggering. So perhaps you could go first, David, and then you may want to come in this point in ICAS as well.
Yes, thank you. So the 54% figure, that was relating to that sector, which was the build-to-rent sector in particular. It probably ties into some of the earlier comments were made, actually, about perceptions, because much of that money will be coming from long-term investors, pension funds and other major investors, both within the UK, but sometimes from overseas as well. So perceptions matter, and I know from my own experience of being down in London for a couple of months in the summer, that the housing bill was predominating a lot of investors' perspectives on Scotland, and it was literally a case of we'll not be investing for the time being whilst we wait to see what the outcome is on that point of view. And unfortunately, since that time, some of that became reality as different developments, which between themselves represented hundreds of millions of investment in jobs, new housing, new modern quality housing, has been switched or lost. All those sites now up for sale and moving. So I think our point in the submission was that this was a big potential loss to the Scottish economy, because the appetite is there, because we're seeing it happen south of the border. Our worry was that whilst there's uncertainty, and actually, I mean, Alan made the point earlier about other policy decisions on council tax you were talking about at the time. But, I mean, I think the housing bill did create that uncertainty. We're aware that, obviously, there was a programme for government. There's been a statement by the First Minister in that since, so we now see what will come from that. But that was a key concern. In terms of the capital investment reduction, 20% reduction, a lot of development needs infrastructure to be able to go forward. And it is development that really gives you the kickstart in the economy. I think we've estimated elsewhere for every 100 million in new demand, you get a further 73 million added into the wider economy at some stage. And that's just the commercial sector. So house building would actually be much greater in total. So if you don't have that capital budgets, that will make it hard for investments in flood prevention schemes, in new transport links, public or road, in healthcare even was mentioned earlier, education and so forth. Yes, developers contribute, but the capacity to do so will only ever be probably a small part of that overall requirement for the infrastructure.
It seems we've leapt from taxation into capital expenditure. Ewan?
I agree with some of the points that are made there about the reasons for the decline in construction activity. I mean, part of it is regulation and part of it is incentives. Regulation is in my experience, holding back construction activity in social housing by quite a significant extent. And we've had uncertainty of what the standards are going to be for quite a long time. So a lot of the people that I work with are just looking for certainty of what the standards are in order to invest. And it's taken around 2 or 3 years to get to the point where we have standards. But there's also the issue of incentives, and incentives that we are putting into housing to ensure that they are compatible with net zero. They're all focused on single measures, which has led to a supply chain that's focused on delivering single measures to houses such as solar panels or wall insulation rather than a comprehensive package of measures. And what we're trying to do at the North East Scotland Retrofit Hub is develop a hub that can take oil and gas workers who have transferable skills such as electricians and people that can work servicing heat pumps, to get them to work on working towards improving houses comprehensively. But to do that, incentives need to allow capital expenditure or funding to be spent on a wider variety of measures. And those wider variety of measures need professional expertise in the form of something like a retrofit hub to enable professionals such as architects, engineers, surveyors to advise what needs to be done to specific houses rather than specific measures for specific houses such as solar panels. It seems to be more targets driven rather than outcomes driven in my particular sector.
Thank you. Alan, you've been very patient, to be followed by Michael Kellett.
Just as all right, I was going to come in on Liz Smith's point about economic inactivity, or if we've moved on from that.
No. If you want to say your piece on that, feel free.
Yeah, it's more just like how we think about economic inactivity. So, for example, if you, and I'm saying you generally, but we all know that care work is much more likely to be carried out by women. If you are caring for, say, your elderly parent and you cannot get appropriate work because, you know, say taking it on will not balance out what you'd lose in a carer support payment, you'll be considered economically inactive. If you're caring for someone else's dad, you're doing exactly the same thing, but you're doing that as your paid job. Like, you are economically inactive. That's a job. So I suppose it's just thinking about how we square these kind of what we are viewing as economically inactive and inactive, because the contribution that is made by care to the economy is very significant. And if that person wasn't providing that care for their father, someone else would have to be probably at the cost of the public purse. So I've not got like a really like great like clever thing to come up with there, but it's more just that it is difficult. That economic inactivity isn't as simple as, oh, someone's not contributing usefully to society. Lots of people who are economically inactive are doing very, very useful work that would be quite costly to replace. And I suppose, particularly in the point about carers, I suppose one of the things that's within the gift of the Scottish Government, and I know that it is considering this in terms of reforms to the carer support payment, is how do you set up the social security system to better support people into work, so you have less, for example, of that cliff edge where if you earn over a certain amount, you will then end up losing more in the carer support payment than you get from extra hours. So just, I suppose, a little bit about a change of how we think about economic activity and what counts as inactive.
Michael Kelly, to be followed by Alice.
It's going to be, my point is back to that one of economic activity, inactivity as well. And I endorse what Alan said about not underestimating the value of unpaid care in a society. There was a particular point, convener, that builds on what Lou said earlier about how do you get closer to the individuals who are farther from the labour market. This is not a perfect solution, but one of the projects we're leading in Public Health Scotland with government and with the rest of the NHS in Scotland is emphasising and encouraging people to think about anchor institution concepts. So this is recognising, particularly for public sector institutions, that the power they have as an employer is really important, and how do they exercise that power. So how do they think about who they bring into their labour market? The NHS, clearly the biggest employer in Scotland, I think somewhere around 180,000 people. each board has an activity plan about an anchor institution. One of the things it requires them to do is to think about how do they bring people into the labour market that might not have done previously. We're also working with Sir Michael Marmot and his Institute of Health Equity based at UCL in London around the kind of Marmot cities or communities approach. One of the emphases there is around thinking about the private sector's role as a good employer and that being something that about how the private sector kind of provides good jobs for the people work for that institute alongside Legal in General produced a really, I think, powerful prospectus around how the private sector should think about its role in terms of improving employability and tackling inequalities a couple of years ago. And if it would be helpful to the committee, I'd be happy to share that. It's quite a powerful prospectus, convener. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Now, Alice, I was going to turn to you next. Anyway, you've got your own contribution to make, but one of the things you said in your submission was that Scottish tax decisions and quality of service provision are highly sensitive to changes which may compare unfavourably with the rest of the UK. Does Scotland ever compare favourably with the rest of the UK? For example, others have suggested that, you know, people might want to come to Scotland because of the, you know, the additional kind of social provisions that you actually get here, you know, free tuition fees, free personal care for the elderly, free eye tests, dental checkups, if you can get a dentist indeed these days. So I'm just wondering if you could respond to that. Always seems to be one-way traffic.
Sure, of course. Can I just get a page reference number for that, please?
Yes, I will. It's the third page of your own submission, second paragraph. Okay.
Sorry, I don't see that, but if I just go ahead and answer that. I think, yes, indeed, we don't have any figures on that. Obviously, there's a positive attractive element, and that's part of one of the factors in terms of attracting people into Scotland as an attractive place to live and build a business.
Example, just we were in Dundee University, yeah. And we were talking to life sciences people who said, you know, these folk can earn twice as much in other parts of the world. Yeah. But they come to Scotland because it's a good quality of life, yeah. Nice place to live, house prices aren't that high, council tax. I know people have talked about increasing council tax, but it's on average more than £700 more than it is in England. £700 less than it would be for equivalent in England, same band. So, band D. So, you know, it just seems to be that, oh, if we put tax up by 0.1%, you know, it's going to be, oh, nobody's going to want to come and invest here. There is an issue that Professor David Bell raised, which was loss aversion. You know, you give someone £100 and they just shrug their shoulders, you take that £100 away and it's the end of the civilization. Do you know what I mean? So there's an issue about that, loss aversion. So anyway, apologies, just if you would like to make your own contribution and respond to the point I've made about that, about this balance between investing in the kind of social contract, as the government might call it, and higher tax levels.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree with what you're saying at all. I think there's definitely a sort of a multifaceted approach to decision making in terms of what attracts people to Scotland.
Okay, and apologies because you wanted to come in with something else on your own.
I'd like to just comment on the capital and revenue expenditure point Michelle raised, but if I may answer it just in two steps. So the first is really about we believe that managing public finances on a longer horizon is a crucial tool for meeting the public sector challenges. It's not just good practice, but it better matches the longer term needs of the public sector. The longer term horizons will offer greater flexibility to manage those challenges and to think through the consequences, keep aligned with strategic directions and priorities. We do have the view that the short-term decisions for longer-term problems risk being costlier. So the capital expenditure side, we agree with what David was saying about it's investing in the future, helping to promote efficiencies and improvements over the longer term. We do see that that normally your capital and your revenue costs are split so that you don't take money from capital to fund your annual revenue costs. And we do see some bodies actually getting permissions to buy money from the revenue budget, from the capital budget to the revenue budget. And this is not good financial practice, but it's clearly been used as a sort of pragmatic short-term solution to pressing budgetary challenges.
Okay, thank you for that. Lewis?
Yeah, thank you. I won't press the button this time. So on public opinion, a poll carried out by IPPR Scotland in the summer, 2nd of August, 4th of August, showed that the majority of Labour, SNP, Liberal Democrat and Green voters support higher taxation. We are not living in a world where the majority of people in this country do not want to be taxed. Indeed, it's quite the opposite. Often these are quite slim majorities, but they are majorities nonetheless.
Other people to pay higher taxes. So while they pay higher taxes, it's the easiest thing in the world to ask people who are not earning much, do you think that people who are earning a lot should pay higher taxes? But what we're looking at is how it would impact on the Scottish budget and the Scottish economy.
Yeah, I understand that. And I think the poll actually asked questions that went into would you be willing to pay more high tax or and other people's. So it wasn't one directional there. The point I'm really making here is that is going back to the perceptions of us being too highly taxed. I think perception is really important, but if we start showing some of the evidence that, as he says, that perception amongst the majority of employees in this country isn't the case, that might change the perception of investors. I think the other thing about taxing through income, we often get into a very limited conversation on what tax is, and focus solely on income from employment. Now, of course, there are really important levers that remain in Westminster around taxing other forms of income, namely from investment. And we need to see movement on that, there's no doubt. But there are ways to tax wealth in Scotland that broaden the tax base away from income. And the most obvious one is the most immovable asset of all, land and property. With council tax, you mentioned that we pay a lower rate here. Now, that may be a positive thing for some, but it's not positive for the finances of local authorities across this country. And changing the system to make it fairer, so the majority will continue to pay a lower amount, making it a percentage of value property tax, or indeed shifting towards a long-term model of land value taxation, is a realistic, yes, long-term, and needs a lot of work in the interim, of making the tax system fairer and giving us the potential to raise significantly more income for local government spending.
And how do you think the perception would be in the differences between Scotland and the rest of the UK? Because it's clear that the new UK government is not going down the road. I don't think there's any plans for them to, for example, you know, revalue council tax or bring in a land tax, etc., etc. How do you think that would impact on the balance in terms of how people perceive Scotland and England in terms of their standard of living, if you like?
You know, I think we've seen in recent years that Scotland can be a global leader on issues, you know, and not for today's discussion, but the loss and damage finance issue is a case in point. Yeah. Scotland can set the example globally and within the UK. I don't think it's without the realms of possibility that Scotland sets a progressive direction and the rest of the UK follows. That said, pressure on the UK government to implement some of the changes that remain in reserved fiscal powers is absolutely vital. It's not one or the other, it's both.
Okay, I think you've got a bit of an uphill struggle convincing the voters of that, I have to be honest. Michael Mara?
It's interesting this area that we're talking about, almost the stability issue in terms of longer-term investment. We're talking about where we're getting the money from, but how it might be spent. And I think Public Health Scotland said in their submission in the current climate there's a tendency towards more reactive short-term responses. We're now in the third year of emergency budget cuts. In-year budget cuts from the finance secretary and very short-term decisions within the financial year. And I wondered whether anybody could, from the witnesses we have, talk to some of the challenges that creates within organisations that they might be representing, whether that be in the health service or whether it be users of services more generally.
Okay, fine. Ewan would like to come in.
Yeah, in the construction industry, one of the problems we face is not having certainty over multi-year funding periods. So often a project will get to a certain stage, but you're racing to get the financial year runs from April to April. And in the construction industry, that means that you get funding approved in April and the project starting just before the winter starts. So having 3-year funding cycles for construction would make a big impact on construction projects getting off the ground. And in relation to retrofit as well, of housing, we have a situation where the funding's being cut, and obviously the ScotWind financing that was raised is now being moved into day-to-day spending by and large, whereas that it was originally ring-fenced for net zero, which would have had a significant impact on the economy of Scotland if it was put into something like encouraging retrofit, where people could reskill into retrofit in order to get people working from the northeast that are maybe wanting to transition out of oil and gas. So I think it is important that we when we make commitments, that it is something that is followed through on a multi-year.
I was optimistic that that might change after the budget on the 30th of October, but as has been pointed out, we're already a 5-year 20% reduction in capital, so there's inevitably going to be reductions, you know, here, there, and probably just about everywhere.
Multi-year settlements would be a good thing, but multi-month settlements would be a good thing too. At the moment, it seems that within year, there are projects that are just being thrown into turmoil because budgets are being cut across the board, you know, within year rather than year to year. So it is a slightly different point, I think, I'm trying to emphasise, rather, because I absolutely agree longer term multi-year settlements can help mitigate against some of that. But at the moment, the management of the public's finances in Scotland is resulting in year chaos in the way these things happen.
Yeah, there's been reallocation of funding because of a pay rise, of course, as we know. Right, I'm going to move on to public service reform because we're more or less halfway through our time, and I think it's a really important issue to address. Michael Kellett, in your submission, you talk a lot about prevention now. Between 2011 and 2016, the Finance Committee discussed that in great depth following the Christie Commission report, which we still refer back to. At that time, the first 3 years of that parliamentary session, the Finance Secretary provided £500 million for prevention. There were a number of initiatives, you know, family nurse partnerships, for example, very successful in the NHS. But the difficulty that we had, and if John Mason was here, he would certainly talk about it, is organisations persistently will say, we're keen on prevention if you give us extra money, but they won't disinvest in projects that are not providing value for money in order to invest in prevention. So how do you address that particular issue at a time of great financial challenge?
Thanks, Convener. I don't pretend to have the perfect answer, but I think recognising from the get-go that prevention does happen, as you've said, family nurse partnerships are an example. In the health service, the work we're doing in vaccinations is a very good example of prevention. So there is investment in prevention that sustains. But you're right, we haven't delivered on the Christie Commission in reality, and that's because of some of the financial pressures that members of the committee and others have talked about. We think we need to take a step back and rethink our approach to prevention as a society. There's loads of evidence around if you invest upstream that the return on investment is much greater than if you're involved in treatment from a health perspective or trying to deal with failure demand. As we said in our submission, convener, we believe a focus on primary prevention and tackling inequalities is absolutely vital. It will reduce demand on pressed public services, including the health service, and should free up resources for future investment. But as you've said, nobody argues with the merits of prevention. Actually delivering it is the really hard part, particularly at the present time. And as you, Convener, and Mr. Mara said, with public services really struggling to, in terms of their challenging financial circumstances. So we've made two practical suggestions, convener, that we think the committee and others may want to consider. The case made by Demos and other think tanks, the Health Foundations, others around a category of public expenditure on preventative spend, so you would have resource spending, capital spend and preventative spend that could give us a benchmark on investment and prevention and allow public bodies in particular to be held account for that continued investment over time might be a way forward.
Yes, are you arguing that the NHS at the moment should have its budget divided into these three areas? Or are you arguing that they should have these three areas but with additional money added for prevention? Because that's not really what we're saying is if you're going to spend on prevention, you have to look at disinvestment. Let's just give you one example. In that parliament, we took evidence from Birmingham City Council who had actually done a lot in terms of prevention. And they said that it was very difficult. We had to go to social workers who had done a job for 35 years, which had been, frankly, completely useless. Right? That's their term, not the term I used, because I don't know what they do in the social work department. And we had to get these people doing things in a completely different way, a different mindset. But we had to do that because the amount of money that this non-service was actually costing was immense. So I'm not saying there are any areas of the NHS which are equivalent, but what I'm saying is, you know, if you've got effectively a fixed budget as we have in the Scottish Parliament, the days when the Secretary is going to stand up and say, by the way, I'm going to allocate £500 million for preventive spend over the next 3 years, didn't work the last time because folk just wouldn't disinvest. So are you saying it should be within that money allocated to the NHS?
Yes.
You hive off a section? Yes,
convener. And it's not hiving off, but it's
well, sorry, that's a wrong expression.
But we recognise that financial pressure, yeah. So we're not naive in thinking that there's kind of extra resources coming over the hill, but we do think a focus on prevention, recognising that the NHS already and other public sector bodies do spend lots of resource on prevention. One of the arguments we've been making to our territorial delivery health boards is that the focus they have on supporting the health and well-being of children in earlier years is really, really important. The work of health visitors, family nurse partnerships, etc. And one of the things we are arguing and suggesting and promoting within the wider NHS community is that absolutely the wrong thing to do would be to reduce that funding. And there are other examples of really important preventing funding that's already happened. But if you were to create that other category of public expenditure, and it's an idea that others have promoted, we think it's worth consideration. It would allow you to track that preventative kind of investment and impact over time in a way that would be really useful. The other thing we think is important, and it's married to that, is how can we deliver a system of accountability, particularly for public sector bodies that focuses on prevention, so that in terms of how public bodies are held to account, it's not just about the immediate delivery, but focuses on what are they doing to get upstream to stop people falling into the proverbial river in the first place. And that's seen as an important factor of success as their delivery of more immediate services are. So it's a mind shift. Convener, don't pretend it's easy. I sit in round rooms with I'm effectively the Director of Finance for Public Health Scotland, with colleagues in territorial boards who are wrestling with really difficult decisions, got real pressure around waiting times,
but
around
D&E
performance.
To be fair, the NHS does do a lot. You talked about vaccinations,
yes,
but
exactly.
Also eye tests.
Exactly.
The eye tests are there to avoid problems coming later down the line. It'll cost a lot more.
Yeah, and as we said in we've given some examples in the two-pager that went alongside the provision. There's some really good examples of effective intervention. The Child Smile programme in Scotland has been hugely successful in changing the oral health of children in our society over a number of years now. So there are really good examples to build on, convener.
Indeed. Okay, I've got three people now wanting to come in so far. So Heather, followed by David.
Thank you. So in terms of, I suppose, public sector reform, and one of the things that Ewan says that it would be something that we would echo is that actually one of the things that we need to get better at is looking at how we use the outcome framework to actually drive our to drive expenditure, that we need to become more outcome focused in our budgetary processes, and there needs to be greater transparency. We need to be able to follow the money from the Scottish Government budget to health board budgets to local council budgets, to be able to actually see what is happening with public expenditure in Scotland. It's very, very difficult to do that. It's exceedingly difficult to do that when there's in-year changes, that can make it difficult to be able to do that. I think one of the other things that we really struggle for, and Ewan touched on this as well, is that siloed approach that we take in terms of our focus on the way in which we approach issues in Scotland. One of the key targets for the Scottish Government, but also for local authorities, is around child poverty. We have child poverty plans, and yet when we look at things like non-residential social care charging, child poverty doesn't even come into consideration. So there's a lack of policy coherence in the public sector. We also have integrated joint boards where, you know, at budget times, we have councils who sit and say, yeah, we've passed a balanced budget, aren't we wonderful? Whereas the integrated joint board is sitting with £30 million savings that need to be made. So integration actually hasn't been integration in terms of budgets. So when we think about public sector reform, we need to move away from the siloed approaches that we currently have in delivery and think about outcomes and have that overview of actually, if we do this at this point, what is that going to mean downstream? How is that going to affect the NHS? Whereas at the moment, all I do is I look at my little bit of the pie, whether that be in retrofit and active travel, whatever that may be, and we don't consider what does that then mean for other areas. And part of the problem that we have is that we're really bad at analysing what is the impact of our decisions. So the public sector equality duty, the way in which that is, I am actually delivered and practiced is really poor. Our analysis of the issues, our analysis of prevention, our analysis of who the decisions that we are taking is going to impact on, who's going to benefit from it, who's not going to benefit from it, is really, really poor within the public sector.
Thank you. Now, David, you've said in terms of public reform, there's a widespread lack of resource capacity and ultimately delivery.
Yes, I mean, for our sector, their interactions with public sector services would very often be in the realms of planning or building services, or it could be the statutory agencies from HES through to CEPA and Transport Scotland and so on. Probably a common theme, particularly in the local services sector, would be a lack of resource in terms of people. And a growing concern, actually, in that the experienced, skilled people who are there are probably nearing the end of their time. So that can have significant consequences. For example, a lack of fire safety experts can delay approvals for developments and buildings, or indeed retrofit remediation, cladding remediation, obviously, only a couple of weeks or so after the second Grenfell report. So these can have very practical and consequences for the delivery of developments. What I would say is I think that there is a lot of innovation going on right now. So local authorities are investing, for example, in graduate apprenticeships and have had some good successes in that scope. So are certain educational institutions, UHI, for example, I think have actually increased their course construction and built environment based on graduate apprenticeships. And we're also seeing the Building Standards Hub recently launched, hosted by Fife Council just a couple of weeks ago, which should help to create consistency and hopefully efficiency, improved performance across Scotland in that field. Planning Hub was launched in the Programme for Government last week, albeit we do hope it will move beyond concentrating on hydrogen and go into the wider planning areas. So the resource pressures has clear and practical consequences for the economy. It delays things coming forward, and that is a concern for our members. And we've always said, I think our members on the planning side of things, happy to pay a higher fee. We just wish to see you know, the improved performance that goes with it. That is all. And, of course, the government have their investing in planning.
Going that higher fee comment. Lewis, followed by Jamie.
Thanks. I just wanted to touch on, I suppose, the preventative spend side of things that Michael was talking about, but also the impact assessment and the problems that Heather outlined around seeing budgets and outcomes. This committee, when the First Minister was still the Deputy First Minister, year before last, did an inquiry into what needs to happen around the national outcomes and the national performance framework, which my colleague gave evidence to. And in that committee report, you were quite clear that the national performance framework needs to become the golden thread, I think was the term, that through which all other policy and spend happens. Now, we fully agree with that. And the national performance framework, as I touched on at the start this morning, is a really powerful well-being tool. It's one of the best in the world, actually, from our assessment at Oxfam, and we work on these things globally. But it's not used, and that's quite clear, and it doesn't drive policy and spending. And the question that I ask is, why is that? And our answer, Oxfam and others like Carnegie and the Wellbeing Economy Alliance, fully agree with this and brought out some really interesting research just last week, that the accountability through the legislation that underpins the National Performance Framework is very, very weak. So right now, a public body has to have due regard to the 11 national outcomes. How is that going to drive change towards any of those outcomes? And there has been a commitment from the Scottish Government to bring forward legislation to change just that back in 2021. But sadly, it's been absent from every programme of government since and is absent from the most recent again. And this is the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill. There is detailed research around what that bill could achieve in terms of accountability, strengthening the wording around national outcomes that public bodies and public sector and indeed the Parliament themselves and potentially civil society and others, that not just having regard for the national outcomes, but must show how they are progressing the national outcomes. And that means preventative spend, it means long-term thinking, it means aligning budgets to outcomes. And we need a decision-making context that allows that accountability to happen, and currently we don't think that's there.
We're actually taking evidence on that immediately after the session. Lewis. Jamie, to be followed by Michael Kelly.
Thanks very much. It was just going back to the point actually that Heather made and silos. And obviously, you know, in an area like mine, the Highlands and Islands, if you have people that find it hard to keep their homes warm, as we have some of the highest levels of fuel poverty anywhere in the country, they're more likely to unfortunately fall into needing NHS services. We're seeing NHS services under huge pressure. And you talked, Heather, about silos in that even within the health services, we're seeing, you know, primary care and secondary care not really integrating. We're therefore seeing areas where, for example, more pressure is being put on the ambulance service because it's not directly under control of NHS bosses. So I was just going to ask kind of a question. Do you feel that, because we've talked very generally about public service reform kind of across the country, but in a rural and island setting, is it almost more important than, you know, in other areas, just simply because there are less choices, less alternatives available?
Excuse me, sorry. I think certainly rurality is, and I should say I've had experience working up in the Highlands for a period of time. Rurality brings many issues to the experiences that people have of delivering public services, but also their experiences of engaging with public services. We've been doing some work with the Highland, the Women's North Highland Women's Health Group, and particularly in relation to women's health services in the Highland. And that's a perfect example of that lack of analysis of how decisions are taken and impact on individual groups, so women in particular, but then how that then impacts on their ability to work and to be able to contribute to the economy. I think rurality is something that we absolutely need to be taken into account. But I think it's that siloed approach that's often that the problem that we have is that we look at the delivery of services by the health service, and you go here for one thing and you go here for something else. People don't live their lives like that. If I have an issue with my housing, that then can impact on my health, it impacts on my finances, it impacts on my ability to work. We need to actually be looking at more place-based services as opposed to that siloed approach that we have, where, you know, the health service does this, local authority does this, and we have this pretendy integration, which actually isn't working in the way that I think it was ever intended, and it certainly isn't providing better outcomes for the most vulnerable who actually need those services to work for them.
Okay, thank you. Michael Kellett, to be followed by Ewan.
Thanks, Convener. A couple of quick points for me. One, just to echo what Lewis said around the National Performance Framework. Like Lewis, I think it's potentially powerful, but its potential hasn't been realised. And I think it goes to what I said earlier, accountability around the national kind of performance and national outcomes is what's really key. And that it's another area where, from our perspective, and we've said this in our submission on it, there's a clear implementation gap. Like Lewis, we were and are still supportive of an approach that would be encompassed in the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill. The experience of Wales there, we think, is an important lesson that we could learn from in Scotland. The second point, Convener, was around that whole system approach that colleagues have talked about. We think that's really important, both at a national and at a local level. We've got an instrument in community planning partnerships that bring together key players locally. We think, and there's work underway to look at that model and see if it can be improved. One of the things we think might bring some kind of value to that table is the work I referenced earlier that we're doing with Sir Michael Marmot and the Institute for Health Equity. We hope by the end of this year to have three kind of emerging Marmot communities, cities, whatever kind of we call them, in local areas across Scotland. We're also doing work with Michael Marmot at a national level, and that will help us think through, based on the experience in Coventry and other places of Marmot communities, how perhaps through bringing partners together locally, including the voluntary sector, public sector and the private sector, we can really think about improving and changing the dial on some of those outcomes, particularly from our perspective or on a health and wellbeing perspective. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Michael. Ewan, to be followed by Ross.
I think just coming back to the point about different parts of Scotland experiencing, you know, having different requirements in the Highlands and Islands, where we do a lot of work. Fuel poverty is a really is much higher than the national average, and partly it is because the electrification of heat has already happened in the Highlands and Islands to a larger extent, without focusing on building fabric of the buildings. If we focus on the building fabric of buildings in our investment, then it has, as we discussed, an impact on various different outcomes, health outcomes, and this has been recognised by the NHS, where some people are being prescribed heat in Scotland. And also it has impacts on people's ability to work. If you live in a cold home, it really affects your motivation. So what we need to see is, if we want to take housing as an example, is looking at what the outcome needs to be and what impacts that will have more widely in someone's life other than paying less in energy bills. So it's focusing investment on things that are going to have the biggest impact on the widest range of outcomes, which reducing the demand from housing does, whereas just installing a heat pump to replace a gas boiler may be much cheaper in the initial term, but will maybe lead to that person paying higher prices and will maybe even make their home colder without focusing on that fabric first approach. So we need a way of getting professionals involved in the development of fabric retrofit projects, and that needs central funding in order to stimulate investment from the private sector to encourage activity in that field.
Ross, before by Alice.
Thanks, Convener. David's point around planning got me thinking of a question. Be interested in folks' thoughts in terms of reform about what level of government power is set at. Because the planning example, I think, is a good one of planning fees are not set by councils. If they're set nationally, many councils make a loss. That doesn't incentivise them to properly resource their planning departments. That has a knock-on effect of significant delays for development. So it strikes me that that's something that's been consulted on recently, so we may well see progress on that. But there's perhaps a wider question there. If we're talking about public sector reform and efficiency, are there any examples that folk have, whether it's around tax spend, something like a final levy, etc., a charge like the planning fees, thoughts on whether we're actually putting these powers at the right level of government to get the most efficient return?
Okay, thank you. Now, Alice, to be followed by Lewis. And Alice, you've got quite a lot to say, actually, about reform. I'm not going to quote your document just yet, but I might. I've got it sitting right in front of me here.
Yeah, I'll need to find the appropriate spot in the document. I've got two points to make, actually. One on reform and the second one about maximising efficiency of expenditure. So on reform, it's sort of around about the definition of reform. It's not just major structural change, but it can also be a series of small steps, which can be quite powerful, which could include comparisons with other bodies, sharing data and good practice, and reducing variations. It's also, I guess, an encouragement and promotion of the culture for focusing on continuous improvement and encouraging ideas from staff and other stakeholders. The second point is around maximising the efficiency of expenditure, which we included in our paper. And some points around that would be to have clear evidence of need and how those specific actions support the delivery of that. It's consistent use of impact assessments, which I believe you raised, Heather, earlier. It's really important to understand, is that actually having the intended impact? And if not, going back and reviewing what needs to be done. And part of that may involve some kind of earlier intervention scrutiny, just to check that the foundations are in place and building maybe a stronger focus on value for money, given the financial circumstances. It's also about what can we learn from the benchmarking and investigating productivity and where that may be causing a blockage, and understanding that.
I mean, what you've actually said, Alice, in your paper is that improving productivity is a key gap in the strategy. Yeah. More emphasis on understanding productivity and why it is decreasing or fluctuating or varying across Scotland and what can be done to address this is critical. So how do we do that?
How do we do that? I think the managers in your organisation...
It's a bit too rhetorical, that's the thing. Looking for answers in this committee.
Well, on the specifics, it's definitely... I think there probably already is quite a lot of work being done. I've given the example of the NHS. But it's maybe not communicated as much for the general public to understand how that is being taken forwards.
And I mean, Heather, in your paper, you've said in terms of, participation, productivity, and indeed Scotland's economic growth and growing the tax base, you've said there's an urgent need to invest in disabled people's employment and address the systemic barriers that prevent disabled people from accessing employment, which is something you've already touched on. I just wonder if you can expand a bit more on that from a
yeah, I can. Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, this perspective here is so huge, actually. But
yeah, I mean, in terms of, so the group that we worked with, in terms of when we looked at the four government priorities, one of their concerns, particularly for the disabled women that were present, but also the women from the Women in Multiple Low-Paid Employment Group, was that when we talk about growing the economy, some of the rhetoric that we have in the UK around those who are economically inactive, and I have to say, as an organisation, we really don't like that term economically inactive, because none of us are economically inactive. We will all be doing something that benefits the economy, whether that's in paid work or not. But the group were very concerned about some of the rhetoric that we have around growing the economy and around social security, particularly for disabled people. And that in terms of what we need to be looking at in terms of productivity and how we can increase the labour force, the numbers of people who are available to work in Scotland, is that we need to look at those structural and systemic issues. So actually, where are the things? And often it's because of public sector failures that those systemic issues happen. So it's about us not seeing the needs of disabled people. It's about us not seeing the needs of women, about taking gender-neutral and gender-blind approaches to our policy and our design of interventions that impact negatively on individuals. So for disabled people in terms of employment, it's about what society can do. So it's about looking at how is that interaction between taxation and benefit system, how does that work? It's about taking into account the additional costs that disabled households have. It's about thinking about how do we, what support do individuals need to be able to get into work. But it's also about employers and employer attitudes. So Lewis mentioned about that carrot and stick and about the incentives that we as the governments can use to encourage individuals, to employers to actually take on their responsibilities and to look at how they can support people with lots of diverse needs in the workforce. We know from, that in terms of how do we increase productivity, it's about having well-supported, healthy individuals within your employees. It's about what the state can do, but it's also about what business can do as well for disabled people.
I think it's also about looking at yourself to an extent. I mean, when I was in Glasgow City Council, they passed a motion that any organisation that contracts with a local authority would have to have at least 3% of its workforce with disabilities, which doesn't seem very ambitious now, but found out that the council itself, less than 1% of its own employees had disabilities. So sometimes people don't look at their own organisations when they're actually looking outwards. Lewis, we fall by Alan.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to pick up on a point that Ewan made around retrofit, but I just also want to acknowledge that Ross Greer asked a question and I missed the question, so I apologise. Otherwise, I would have tried to answer it as well. The point on retrofit of houses and the cost that will mean for Scotland. We did some work last year with IPPR Scotland and the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations on exactly that point. What would the cost be and how should that cost be distributed to ensure that all houses, rural or urban, can retrofit to the level needed and install green heating systems? And what we found is the investment is, less than a third of what it needs to be annually to reach the target. But more importantly, the research also uncovered that the best way to pay for that, the way that makes it cheapest for middle and low income households, is through progressive taxation, not through loans and upfront costs paid for by the household themselves. And I think this brings us full circle back around to the perceptions point. Tax and spend are highly connected, and we need to make the case that it's a more efficient way to deliver this significant investment in something like Heaton buildings through progressive taxation than it would be to do so through households fronting that cost and taking on loan and debt themselves. I just wanted to bring it back to that point on how we can argue and make the case for progressive taxation going further than it already has, if it means ultimately it's cheaper for households.
Okay, but if you're investing actually in retrofitting houses, that's really capital, which is effectively dictated by the UK government. So if there's a limited amount of capital, and it may increase after the budget, it may not, but if a limited amount of capital, should the Scottish Government, for example, I mean, I think I know what Ewan's answer would be, but I'm just asking yourself, Lewis, should the Scottish Government invest more in, for example, retrofitting houses to reduce heating costs, etc., which may have an ongoing health prevention benefit, or rather more affordable houses. I mean, when I was a councillor, I remember, my local repair team being aghast when I said I wanted the windows in 1,500 houses Anyway, and they said, oh, no, you don't want to do that, councillor. You want to get new windows put into 50 houses and then you've got a nice photograph taken in front of the houses, you know, rather than actually repoint them. You point the windows to make them... So instead of 1,500, could have 50. And I said, no, I want them pointed. But the point is, it's about how you allocate resources and effectively. So, for example, if you had the money, do you think retrofitting for the overall Scottish budget in terms of things like how it impacts on people's health and wellbeing, etc., would be better spent on retrofitting for, assuming we had the workers to do it, skilled and trained in number, than actually building new houses? Is that a better bet, do you think? I'm just being devil's advocate here.
I mean, straight up, I don't take a view on that. And the research that we worked on with IPPR Scotland last year also doesn't take a view on that. The crux of the case that we're making is that for the existing housing stock, and that includes social housing, it is more cost effective for the household to put the cost onto progressive taxation. It's not only more cost effective for middle and low income houses, but it's also fairer for everyone than expecting households to take on that cost themselves.
You don't have to be a Mystic Meg to know what you're going to say here, Ewan, but I'll let you say it.
Yeah, so I think it's a good point, and other countries in Europe are doing similar things. For example, in Ireland, there is funding available, significant funding available, up to 50,000 per household to upgrade a house to certain energy efficiency standards. So there's two things that would drive investment, and that's having the standards in place and also having the incentives for people. And it's not just money to upgrade someone's house, it's also money that builds an industry and builds an industry with high-skilled, well-paying jobs. So over time, that would become something that becomes the norm, because in this country, unfortunately, we have some of the worst housing stock in Europe. So we have a much longer way to go to upgrade that housing stock and a lot more investment. But once people see the benefits of retrofit across all tenures, then that would drive people to start to want more from their housing and not put up with a mouldy, damp corner in their bedroom, etc.
Between houses in the Western Isles and the Faroe Isles is absolutely incredible, yeah. and not to the benefit of people in the Western Isles. Alan.
Yeah, so I was actually going to come in, excuse me, on the question that Ross had asked around sort of where powers lie in sort of public service reform. And as a general principle, the Alliance would absolutely agree with sort of localism and the idea of taking as many decisions as possible at the most local and most community level possible, because apart from anything else, taking decisions at a much higher level can feel very disempowering for people in those local communities. But, and this is a risky comment, not so much in this room, but perhaps in council chambers across the country, people need to not be overly protective of their own current remits and instead think about, well, what actually works best for people. So we take the specific example of social care, obviously something we're very, very concerned about. And there's obviously the National Care Service Bill going through Parliament, and that's something other colleagues and other committees will talk about more. But as an evidence session, I think, for pre-budget scrutiny last year, and one of the representatives from local government said they didn't like the term postcode lottery, because these are different local democratic decisions. But if your local council has democratically decided you're not getting care, or that you're going to have to pay through the nose for additional charges for it, that's pretty cold comfort. Like that's you're not going to be, you know, filled with love for the concept of subsidiarity. That's not great. So there's a difficult balance to be struck there. You know, like, how do we ensure that there is both a degree of local flexibility that responds to the different sort of needs of different areas, and particularly in relation to, for example, the difference between urban, rural, island areas, but also that sort of, how do we also ensure at the same time there's a basic floor of standards that, you know, people aren't going to fall below, so that, you know, your rights are being upheld and you can access these fundamental services. And I suppose that when we're talking about public sector reform and the balance of power between national and local government, it's important to get that balance right and not to do things just because that's the way they've already been, or for fear of upsetting one level or another of government, but instead thinking, well, what is actually going to work best for people here? Because again, on that point of social care, and I think an example specifically is Aberdeenshire versus Moray, someone who is just across the border in Aberdeenshire from Moray will get less access to social care than across the border. And local government aside, that's just not fair for people, and it doesn't deliver on their basic human rights and needs.
be seen whether the National Care Service will resolve such issues it's supposed to. Okay, we're almost at the end of our time, and what I would like to do here at this point is to ask all of our guests to think for a minute or two about any final points they want to make on any issue we haven't covered or anything we have covered that they wish to re-emphasise. And the person who will be last to ask to give his view will be yourself, Alan, because you went first earlier today, so you've got more time to think. So I'm looking for volunteers to step up to the plate. Otherwise, I shall do an eeny, meeny, miny, mo, and just... Well, Lewis has volunteered. On you go, Lewis.
Thanks. I'm just trying to get out of the way for you, to be honest.
Is that right?
Yeah. One of the things that the call for evidence questions focus down on in relation to tax that we've not discussed today is the tax strategy.
Yes.
We expect to see that in November, before the budget in December. And obviously it's been framed as building on the 2021 framework for tax. Now, we did an assessment of that in part of our evidence submission, and one of the things I'd just like to emphasise is that as the government develops this tax strategy through the consultation that's taking place over the course of the next 6 weeks or so, that we have to see beyond the conceptual side of things that the 2021 framework did quite well to articulate. You know, it had strategic objectives, it had expressions of what tax should be for, but it failed to adequately articulate how the Scottish Government intends in practice to use and reform devolved taxes to deliver on objectives. And I think this new strategy needs to do that. It needs to move beyond a theoretical model, set a clear strategic direction for tax, and that includes making choices on whether or not we want to use the tax system to redistribute or whether we want to use tax to do other specific things. I guess the final point on the tax strategy is that the framework for tax set out a programme for work in 2021. Very little of that programme for work was actually delivered on. Some remains unstarted, other things remain delayed. We think that the tax strategy must transparently commit to a series of work that aligns to that strategic objective that lays out.
Okay, now I've noticed throughout your document though you say things like, you know, Scotland's income tax system needs to raise more money than the rest of the UK. We need to enable significantly more public spending on people, public services and green infrastructure to improve the adequacy of social security entitlements. But one thing you've been very coy about is how much additional resources should be raised, for example, for these. I mean, is it an extra 10 million, an extra 100 million, an extra billion?
I mean, you know, organisations have been quite clear. If you were to see, just picking an example over there, an array of things that we think we should spend more money on, you know, the Scottish Shell payment, if we were to increase that up to the £40 that were necessary, there's quite clear figures attached to that. To be honest, it slipped my mind right now, but it's in the hundreds of millions, and it could be costed and paid for by specific changes to taxation.
How much additional money would you raise, though, is the issue?
The short answer is I don't have a response to that, and equally, it's a lot.
Right, OK, fine. Right, David? And then Michael?
Thank you. I'll just be quick. Just quickly on the point of incentives for getting into a retrofit, not just of homes, but I'd like to think of retrofit and redevelopment of a lot of the sort of latent potential in the country. There's a lot of older buildings which need to be changed radically. They're not going to return to being offices in many cases. Listed buildings which need to be brought back to life, usually in great locations in urban centres. So I'd like to see the emphasis in terms of incentives towards getting people to invest in their own homes or invest in older buildings and bring them back to life. That touches on things like support for property improvements and not just charging vacant rates to like the full maximum, because that's not going to attract people to do it. And so I think the emphasis on that, because I just, progressive taxation is great, I like the idea of grants for people, but I just observe that the few millions which were raised last year in terms of the change to tax bans, I don't think will make much of a dent in the overall requirements for retrofit.
Michael Kellett.
Very quickly, Convener, I've majored today on a shift to prevention and on making that practicable. I've talked about the importance of improved accountability to make that happen. One thing I didn't mention, Convener, that I think is probably important is just to recognise that the audit environment in Scotland is really important there. And what we've seen in Public Health Scotland from the Accounts Commission and from Audit Scotland is an increasing recognition of their power in holding public bodies to account in terms of their focus on prevention. So that feels positive from my perspective, Convener, and thought I should share that. Thanks.
I'm not getting any volunteers, but there's a guy called Ewan has just caught my eye.
I think that in the context of this committee, investment in housing as infrastructure is something that could stimulate a lot of growth in the Scottish economy. And it just needs to be something that is going to be consistent from year to year to enable industries like the one that I work in to grow. Just now it's a very fragile and young industry, the retrofit industry, but in other countries such as Ireland, where they have provided significant funding, and in Germany, it's given a chance for the industry to become developed. And that gives an opportunity for the transition of jobs of industries that are looking to transition into a net zero future, such as oil and gas, to reskill and drive improvements in the Scottish economy.
Do you hear that?
I suppose just a couple of things. One of the things that we've kind of touched upon a little bit is that lack of accountability that there often is around the outcomes that are coming from public sector investment. And I think that's something that we need to get better at, is linking the decisions that we make to the outcomes that we're trying to achieve and to monitor and evaluating those. And that for us, that comes becomes really important, that we take a gendered lens to the decision making that we're taking, recognising that the decisions that we have a different impact on men and women in society because of the norms and expectations that we have. And if we don't take that equality analysis, what we will end up with is actually making life worse for those that are most vulnerable in our communities, which is what I think we are starting to see in terms of decisions that are being taken, particularly at a local level, in terms of, again, as I say, that lack of policy coherence. You know, programme for government talking about preventative spend, talking about using community places, but when we actually look at local decisions being taken at a local level, those are the things that we're cutting back on. So there's a lack of coherence between what we are saying we're trying to do and actually what's been achieved on the ground, and we need to make sure that we're taking that equalities lens to it, or it's going to end up costing us more money in the long run.
Okay, thank you. Alice.
Yes, a couple of points. Just to kick off, I think the three main points that we have in our paper on this are about promoting a long-term approach to planning. It's also a holistic approach to revenue generation and cost reduction. It's not just about tax. A tax isn't the silver bullet. And the other point is around sort of the importance of it in this context of limited resources. It's to have strong alignment with the priorities, including the cross-lateral, the cross-cutting aspects of services, and understanding the trade-offs. And may I just in case there was a misunderstanding earlier, just like to reaffirm that the point made by the Scottish Fiscal Commission on the behavioural aspects is a significant and important point, even though it's difficult to quantify. And they offer strong credibility that this is a risk that perhaps needs to be looked at.
Okay, and in terms of long-term planning, you're talking about 10, 20, 30 years, but you have different governments and stuff like that with different policy priorities. It's not, how practical is that? You know, that a government would stick to the priorities that someone else decided on 18 years ago.
Yeah, it's just the long-term nature of public service needs doesn't sit well with a 12-month or two, three years strategy, especially on the capital side. And if you're looking at promoting investment to improve future services, then that could be on a very extensive timescale.
And just one thing you've touched on is you've said the Scottish public sector is also comparatively larger than the rest of the UK and better paid with a widening gap. So, yeah. For example, 17% of the workforce in England is in public services, whereas it's 22% in Scotland, and the average salary for the same job is 2,400 higher in Scotland. Yeah. So is that a gap you want narrowed?
I think for that one, it was really just an example of decision-making process. It's nothing to comment on the policy side or the decisions that have been made, and the figures were cited from the Scottish Government document as well. So.
Okay. Thank you. Alan?
Yeah, excuse me. So I just want to end by re-emphasising the Alliance's sort of constant calls for a human rights-based approach to all aspects of public finance, including spend and revenue raising. I mean, I think we can and we have talked about growth and behavioural changes and divergence with the UK, and we can do that till the cows come home. But our starting point shouldn't be what level of tax do we think is acceptable. It should be what kind of society do we think is acceptable in light of our human rights obligations. And then we build our tax and spend around that. And we also take on the hard task of reshaping the narrative to that end, rather than just accepting current narratives around that as unchangeable. And there's a role here for MSPs to take a lead. And I also just, for finally, call back to something David said earlier about how we've been trying no growth since 2007. We didn't try no growth, we tried austerity. That has dominated my entire adult life. I was applying to university when the economy went to pot in 2007, and the Alliance, large parts of civil society, and crucially many economists have been absolutely clear that austerity has not worked and did not work. We would therefore push back very strongly on any glib suggestions that just doing tax cuts and belt tightening will even grow the economy in the first place, as that hasn't been experienced in recent years, never mind give us an economy that works for people where they have good quality of life and their human rights are upheld.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I want to thank all our guests this morning. We're slightly over time, but I think it's worthwhile to get as many contributions as possible from everyone. I hope everyone feels they've been listened to, and we'll take your views into account when we produce our pre-budget draft report. We'll continue our evidence taking on the sustainability of Scotland's finances on the 30th of September, and formal discussions next week with Estonian MPs, officials and relevant organisations on digitisation and reform, as we're off to Estonia for a few days to address these issues. We'll now take a break for 5 minutes to allow for a change of our witnesses before we move on to our next agenda item on the National Performance Framework. is our first evidence session for the Joint Committee inquiry into the Scottish Government's proposed national outcomes, which form part of the National Performance Framework. Welcome to the meeting. Sarah Davidson, Chief Executive of Carnegie UK. Dr. Max French, Assistant Professor, Newcastle Business School, Northumbria University. Dr. Alison Hosey, Research Officer, Scottish Human Rights Commission, and Lucas Bunce, Policy and Engagement Lead, Wellbeing Economy Alliance Scotland. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session. As with the previous panel, if witnesses would like to be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to the clerks, and I can then call you. So thanks for your written submissions. So we'll move straight to questions. And I think one of the first things I should mention is, I'll ask you about, is that none of you seem particularly impressed by the fact that the National Performance Framework is going to continue to be called the National Performance Framework. Is that right? Sarah?
Let me take that one first. Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence today. As the National Performance Framework, currently titled, has evolved over, particularly over recent years, it has come more and more into line with international comparators for what is called a wellbeing framework. And this is something which exists in many countries, both more local to us, so in Wales, in the north of Tyne here in the UK, and in places around the world like Canada, New Zealand, some of the Scandinavian countries. And well-being is a concept which we find that when you talk to people about it, the sense of people thriving, of living well together, it's a concept that people understand. And it can encapsulate many of the things that the framework in Scotland is trying to achieve, economic, environmental, democratic and social outcomes. A national performance framework is something which, in our experience of talking about the framework with people, is much harder to communicate. It's much harder to get people excited about and engaged in. And it's also misleading because, in our view, a well-being framework is not fundamentally about measuring the performance of individual services or indeed directorates of the Scottish Government. It's a vision for a country, a vision of how people would like their country to be in the long term, and a vision which can align people behind it. So I think it's fair to say we were unconvinced at Carnegie UK by the Scottish Government's contention that to change the name now would result in some kind of brand dilution. Because in our experience, while the brand may be recognised within public services, and recognition and effective operation are two different things, as this committee recognised in its inquiry in 2022, there is a huge amount of untapped potential to engage people beyond the public services in a well-being vision for Scotland. And that's why we are disappointed that the government has not accepted that recommendation.
Yeah, I think it's a bit dull as well, actually. But I have to say, I don't think the word framework being included in any title is helpful. Yeah, anyone else want to comment on this before we move on to stuff? Alison?
Just a quick comment. I agree with what Sarah said, that in renaming, in some way, having wellbeing in the title, if that is the key focus of what this is meant to be doing and working towards, I think would have been a good opportunity to and if we are sort of rebranding this and trying to restart and reinvigorate people's enthusiasm for this, then that would have been useful. But I think it's also key to remember that the real difference is whether public bodies and decision makers use the MPF to guide policy to improve outcomes. And so the name is important, but what truly matters is how it's used and how it's implemented. And I think that all needs to be thought through. And wellbeing is something that we have been buying into, and it's a good concept. It's a global concept. And I think it's something that should still be thought through.
Okay, Max, you weren't really very impressed by the consultation exercise that the Scottish Government carried out.
Yeah, and I suppose amongst other things. There's a sort of emerging kind of international consensus about how you do consultation around setting national goals. We sort of started off, I think, with a single online survey as our sort of baseline for that, but really the international practice has become much more ambitious. So we see very searching, large-scale participative processes, national dialogues that set out over a long period of time to engage all sectors of society in setting national outcome goals, because we recognise that the legitimacy of the framework and ultimately the political power that it commands is in large part due to the quality of that consultation. So I was disappointed to see the level of resourcing and the level of attention and given to the National Outcomes Consultation, particularly given criticisms of the 2018 version. This seemed to be more or less a repetition of that with some additions of community participation and workshops. So I felt it could and should have been more ambitious than it was.
Yeah, and Lucas, you seem to also feel that the Scottish Government paid lip service to that. You said we're very disappointed with the Scottish Government's lack of investment to a meaningful consultation process.
Yeah, very much echoing what Max has said, in the sense that I think it really shows how important this is to the government, if you look at how much money they're willing to spend on it, and you know, and it was basically as little as possible, seemed to be have been their approach. And as Max said, I think if we want the wellbeing framework to be that kind of vision for Scotland that people know about, that you know, we can hold decision makers to account, that kind of guides the action to create that kind of, you know, and it is a nice vision, you know, if you, who of us wouldn't want to live in that world that the current national outcomes and maybe the new national outcomes set out. But at the moment, it's just this thing kind of at the sidelines, really, that most people in Scotland probably don't know about. And I think that's, you know, and this consultation would have been a chance to change that and to actually, you know, increase the awareness of it, increase the legitimacy of it. And instead, we've gone backwards, I think, in terms of consultation in some respect. Like, I think there was more, definitely on the community side, there was more last time, as far as I'm aware, even though I wasn't around. So, yeah, just very disappointing, I think.
Okay, and in terms of policy priorities, you've said that it should be emphasised to include the voice of those that are seldom heard and the recognition that a thriving democracy requires opportunities for participation to be accompanied with the sharing of power. So I just wonder if you can expand on that a wee bit for us.
Well, so basically that's coming from the idea, and as I said, I'm here from the Wellbeing Economy Alliance, and our focus is really on redesigning our economy to create, you know, to serve the well-being of people and planet now and in the future as well. And that framework and vision is really important, I think, as a guide for policy making, make sure it's coherent and linked up, and to put that different kind of purpose at the heart of the economy. And one of the principles, very important principles for us of a well-being economy, is that participatory element, is the idea that it's not something you can decide from the top down, but it needs to be included, especially the people who are the most impacted by the failures of our current economic system, because they haven't got enough money to essentially buy food, or they are not able to access transport to the places they need to go. And it's often, and they're not the people who will respond to an online form in the consultation. So you have to go to them, if that makes sense. Like, because they've got other things on their mind than responding to the latest government consultation. So I think that's really where that has come from.
Okay, Alison, you look as if you want to come in on this.
Yeah, it's just in terms of that inclusivity, some work that the Commission's been doing recently in the Highlands and Islands, looking at economic, social, cultural rights, one of the aspects that's coming through from that data and also from Audit Scotland's recent report is on digital connectivity and the large proportion of people, particularly in remote and rural Scotland, that don't have that access in a way that could be able to participate. So it's just one thing that highlights the kind of digital divide and people being able to participate. And if the MPF is to be our, you know, our vision for Scotland, everybody's views have to be part of that. And the MPF team did the best that they could with the data that they had available to them, but they should have been afforded better resources to be able to show the commitment that the Scottish Government, as you say, has to this process.
And Max, you're not particularly impressed about how the national how the framework national outcomes are being implemented. I mean, I sat with my yellow mark and went through, oh, that's a really good point, that's a good point. I've got loads and loads of them annotated here. So, for example, you say things like Scotland has lacked a credible or even discernible implementation strategy for the National Performance Framework since its founding in 2007. You know, and you've talked about how it's internationally recognised, but it's, you know, that even when organisations want to adopt and implement the NPF, they lack the tools, guidance and know-how to implement them operationally. So you're of the view that, yeah, it's a good idea and people have recognised that out with Scotland, but it's not really having much impact on the ground. wonder if you can talk to us. I've got your, obviously, your submission here, but I'm quite keen on you talking on the record on that particular issue.
Certainly. Well, thank you for going through the tome of that submission.
I always do.
The frustrating thing is, I think, that it's not so very far away now to be able to envision a national infrastructure which puts this into practice. It's also, you don't have to look very far. We can look at Wales and see how they've riven their wellbeing goals, objectives, indicators into how they develop policy. So we have practical examples, and in that report that we published with Carnegie UK, we sort of go through some of that, and we can go into detail on how, you know, in planning and implementing and monitoring policy, we can see how the wellbeing framework has sort of contained that process. There's nothing in their legislation directing them to do that. In Northern Ireland, they haven't had a government. They haven't had ministerial oversight, they haven't had an executive, they haven't had forums like these, they haven't had parliamentary scrutiny, but they've still managed to use their framework to, you know, conduct government business. And they've got a much stronger link with local government, with community planning than we do. In Northern Ireland, and in Republic of Ireland, they're using their wellbeing framework in budgeting. And they've got further, given, you know, I think their wellbeing framework has been in operation a year, maybe two, but they've got further down the road than we have. So the solutions are there, and I think fundamentally it's a principle that the MPF just hasn't been taken seriously, and the national outcomes aren't paid due attention. Now, we have a legislative directive. It's not strong enough. It's not clear enough about what it is, but it does say if you're a public body or a body that is involved with carrying out significant public functions, you should have regard for the national outcomes. So we can look through the government's recent output, the Green Industrial Strategy, the NPF isn't mentioned, there's no regard for the national outcomes. The Transport Strategy in 2020, the NPF's mentioned, national outcomes are not. The biodiversity strategy, no mention there. And yet in the Welsh Government, we can look at their versions of these, national planning strategy, transport strategy, recycling strategy, net zero marine strategies, and we can see how that wellbeing framework has been used. So we're in a situation, really, where the actions are in place and the directions forward are quite clear. It's just a matter, really, for me and where I'm sitting, that they're not being followed.
Keen to come in, but I'm just at this point, yeah.
Just on point, given what you say, and irrespective of the debate about the nomenclature, do we actually need a national performance framework?
So, like, I'll take that one first of all. So the short answer is yes, and I'll say why I think that's the case. The value of a framework, whatever you call it, is that it is able to set a long-term vision which sits above the day-to-day noise in the system. And, you know, I think increasingly since the time when the framework was first put in place in 2007, we have seen how the day-to-day challenges of government have only become greater, and there is an understandable focus in individual services on dealing with the problems of today, and those could consume everything and everybody's time and attention. Absent a long-term strategic framework which sets out longer-term goals for a population as a whole, then there's a very significant risk, and indeed the reality that we often saw pre-2007, of a focus on short-term goals without an understanding of how those were going to lead to longer-term objectives for the population. So there's an issue about how do you raise your eyes from what you have to do today to understand what the long-term goal is. But the other critical thing that it does is that it should enable public services and indeed other agencies, other actors, to understand their respective contributions in a horizontal manner to the delivery of outcomes. And again, that's something which we know that absent a cohering framework, there's a high risk of fragmentation across different agencies. And in places like Wales, as Max has described, where you do see that coherent framework in place, you see individual agencies understanding what their integrated contribution to long-term outcomes looks like, whether it's health or whether it's environmental outcomes or educational outcomes. And that seems to me to be a really, really important part of good governance and good administration.
Interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, Alison, you want to come in here?
Yeah, I think, I mean, the MPF is a high-level document, but it can't sit there, up there, and not be used in practice. And right from, I mean, something we've been talking about a lot in, with the Finance Committee as well over recent years in budget, pre-budget scrutiny, is the disconnect between the MPF, which states our national ambition, and the budget, which is what provides the resource to deliver on a national ambition. And in between there, the programme for government. And for me, your national performance framework sets what kind of Scotland we want. From that, therefore, your programme for government on an annual basis should answer to those national outcomes. How is it going to deliver on them? And then your budget, how is it going to resource that? And there is not those connections just now. We can't make those lines between the two. In your previous session on scrutiny of the budget this morning, you were making the issues around disinvestment and how do you know when something is working and not working and what you should invest in and not invest in? And unless we really look from an outcomes-based perspective at what is working and what is not, we're not going to be investing in the right things. And this all needs, these three documents, three policy documents, are probably the three most critical documents the Scottish Government produces. They need to talk to each other.
Okay, thanks. Yes, Lucas.
Yeah, just briefly building on that, I think it's really... Yeah, it's really important in the sense that a lot of the challenges we're facing, whether it's climate change, even poverty and inequality, are like long-term challenges. We're not going to get grips with them over the course of one parliament. And so if we want to, you know, ensure that we do create that kind of better society, we need to have a long-term perspective and long-term goals. And also we need, you know, all of these to talk to each other and to make sure that somebody working on this goal isn't accidentally making this one worse, or if they have to, then at least we have to have a way to think through it. And that's not happening at the moment, I think. It's like some of my colleagues who use a really good analogy, which I think is a Rubik's Cube. So if you're trying to solve that, you have to always think about all the sides, because if you just try to solve one side, and then you start making the other ones worse again. And that's kind of what the NPF is for. And ideally, it should set, as Sarah said, a bit above the political fray, in the sense of this is what we can actually all agree on. We might disagree on how we get there and what the specific policies are, but at least we kind of have a common destination. And it is often, and that sounds kind of abstract, but it's perfectly possible to do that. Like if you look at the kind of work that has been going on in New Zealand at the wellbeing budgeting, and there's a few other examples as well, like it's not easy, but you can do that kind of analysis when you set budget lines, if you set policies, to figure out how, you know, have a think through how they impact different outcomes at once.
Thank you. Can I just ask why you think that the three different documents are not talking to each other? Where lies the problem about the lack of coherency?
From reading the budget over the last few years and trying to do some kind of scrutiny on whether or not the budget's delivering on economic, social and cultural rights, that's where my focus has been the last few years. It's been really difficult to try and see the links between budget and delivery on outcomes. And so through the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, we've been doing a lot of work trying to improve the synergy between those documents. And there has been a lot of work over the last few years to try and make, I suppose, that the understanding of what national outcomes and what human rights framework is relevant to what different government departments, and to reflect that within the budget, to think through from the starting point of a budget what impacts the decisions have on people. That bit is missing still for me. There is a kind of, it almost feels like it's after the fact, after the decisions are made, that we see maybe what the impacts might be. And I don't think that what we're trying to do in terms of delivering the national outcomes is reflected in that budget. Something that the Commission's been working on over the last 6-7 months is trying to better understand, so that we can be held accountable for our actions and our outcomes, is what contributions we make to impact. And it's quite difficult to sometimes unpick when something like the National Performance Framework, there are lots of actors, not just on the Scottish Government, to deliver. So what is their contribution to that? And I don't think they are setting that out so that, and they can't be held accountable for it if they're not setting out what it is that they're saying they're trying to achieve. So it's that bit, it's that theory of change. What is it you're trying to achieve? How do you intend to do that? How do you intend to resource that? And that linkage, I think, is missing.
And I think just picking up on that last point that Alison made about accountability is I think we should be clear that aligning budgets with national outcomes is not straightforward, and lots of countries which are trying to do this are wrestling with it. But we believe that it's worth trying to do for the reasons that have been set out. But one of the impediments that we have in Scotland is the system accountability, where one of the most felt accountabilities for any public servant is their accountability for their expenditure of money. And at the moment, accountabilities are quite narrowly aligned with organisational responsibilities. And as you will know better than most, the way in which budgets are presented to Parliament are in line with ministerial portfolio accountabilities rather than those cross-cutting outcomes. And although Audit Scotland and the Auditor General have gone further in recent years to pass commentary on the extent to which that's supporting outcomes, there's still a misalignment between what people feel held accountable for and the long-term vision.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that, Liz. Alison, what you've said is that what's important is that we have a more streamlined, simple and bold statement of what the National Performance Framework is. And you've also said that resources and support for capacity building across public bodies will be essential to align operations with national outcomes. So what are we talking about in terms of resources and support?
Sorry, could you just repeat that last bit?
Yes, sorry. You've said also in the key points that you've put in your submission that, and I quote, resources and support for capacity building across public bodies will be essential to align operations with the national outcome. So I'm asking what kind of resources and support do you think will be required to deliver that?
I think it is in terms of capacity building, and it goes back to the points made earlier about the lack of prominence of the MPF across different parts of government, local government, public bodies, in terms of its importance and the due regard that we don't feel coming through at the moment from other areas. I know reflecting in a session recently with the government team around the history of the MPF and where it came from and how it's developed, it had much more prominence at the start. Local authorities were thinking about and were asked to and did report on how they made those connections and why the MPF was important and what national outcomes their various areas and portfolios of work would work towards. And that's disappeared. So an understanding of the importance of the MPF, an understanding of grounding the work that you do in what it is that you're trying to deliver, it's that capacity building, and that's where I think there is resource. It's not just financial resource, it's human resource, and it's knowledge exchange. And it's building that prominence of the MPF back through the work that public bodies do.
And Sarah, I'm just about to bring you in anyway, because you've said in your submission that existing duties are too weak to establish the national outcomes as key drivers of decision making.
Yeah. So just picking up on where Alison ended there, one of the things that we know from Max's work in Wales and what we have observed in Wales as well, pardon me, is that the support, the fact that in legislation ways of working are specified that will help to deliver these long-term outcomes has been really significant in bringing the capacity building in behind it. So in Wales, it happens to be located in the Office of the Future Generations Commissioner. It could be located in different places. But there is work done there in order to help public bodies to understand what it means to work in these different ways. So, for example, to teach people how to use foresight and horizon scanning information in a way that helps them to give good policy advice to ministers. And although there was some of that in Scotland, and there was some of that in a team within the Scottish Government that helped to support collective leadership across the public services, it was always under-resourced. And that team doesn't exist anymore, and the capacity building has more or less disappeared. And I think that connects to the point that you've just made, Convener, about duties. Because if a public body feels that a duty matters and it has to do something about it, then one would hope that it would follow that duty with building up the competence within its own organisation to deliver and holding people to account within the organisation for that delivery. And again, I think we can extrapolate from the fact that we're not seeing the National Performance Framework really driving alignment and activity within Scottish public bodies, that duty that exists at the moment to have regard for the national outcomes is not really worth the paper that it's written on. And again, it's interesting to hear the Welsh story. Jane Davidson, who was the Assembly Member in Wales, who was responsible for the introduction of the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act in Wales. What impelled her to do that was her experience as a minister in the Welsh Government of very similar sort of soft duties, as you might call it. And the legislation in Wales was designed to toughen up that duty and to make it meaningful for public bodies.
Max?
I'd agree with all of that. I also think it's worth reflecting on where Wales has got to without its legislative duties. There's nothing in the Welsh legislation that requires the Welsh Government to run its wellbeing framework through its programme for government, for instance. But yet it does, and it's chosen to do that. It's made an active choice. It reports annually based on its wellbeing objectives, which are aligned with its wellbeing goals. And again, it's made a choice to do that. And the reason is that it is riven through the culture in the Welsh Government in a way that it never has in the Scottish experience. Now, you can't separate that from the real hard powers that Wales has in comparison to Scotland. But it is worth reflecting on the fact that the Scottish Government has removed the NPF and the national outcomes from its most recent programme for government. There's not a mention. There was last year. There was the year before. The year before that, it was mentioned. But this year, it has disappeared. And that, you know, what we conclude from that as a public body, surely the message is don't pay attention too much to when we've told you to have regard to the national outcomes.
Yes, the subliminal message is quite clear in your view on that. Mm-hmm. Alison, did you want to comment on this?
I agree with that.
Max, you've mentioned a number of issues where things can be improved. You talked about convening power, big fan of that. Framing power, leadership, hard powers, and introducing innovation funds, reconfiguring current reporting, Scottish Government's procurement, pursuing a performance budgeting approach. So I just wonder if you can talk a wee bit more about that for the record. We've got the submissions here, but just for the kind of oral
record. Well, to give you the context of that, I probably sat down for half an hour, 45 minutes, dreaming up those mechanisms. Mm. But the lesson from that is it's not too difficult. We could get round a room together and we could bash those out, and we would have a conceivable implementation plan that we could take forward from the Scottish Government. We'd also find parallel for most of those in how other countries, other regions, other cities have gone through and thinking and using about their outcomes framework, whether that's a wellbeing framework or is positioned otherwise. So there's mechanisms there, and there's things that we could do at zero cost. There are things that we could do with a Future Generations Commissioner at £1.5, £2 million per year. There are things in between, but there's a quiet, I suppose, in terms of the messaging from the Scottish Government following its commitment to develop an implementation plan and provide leadership for the NPF. The Wellbeing Sustainability Bill was Sustainable Development Bill was one mechanism that, you know, we spent a lot of time thinking about how that could be used. Now that's no longer in the programme for government. So there are mechanisms we can think about and we can use, but the question is, you know, what is on the table here and how can we start moving forward?
Now, Lucas, Max has mentioned the C-word commissioner. You probably know that we've undertaken quite an extensive review and produced a 34-page report, which was only published yesterday, suggesting a moratorium on commissioners. What's your view of why this commissioner is particularly important and why it has to be, the work of a suggested commissioner has to be done via a commissioner?
I think, to be very clear, I think that commissioner is the best way to do that work. It might not be the only way, but we think that is the best way, and that is for various reasons. Like, as we've just had a long discussion, we need to do that capacity building if we want the NPF to to work to its full extent. Somebody needs to do the training, somebody needs to develop the resources, and actually having that in one central place I think would be really useful. There's also a point about, as we said, about accountability, and I think somebody having that overview perspective, I think Sophie Howe, she spoke at the the Wellbeing Economy Cross-Party Group a couple of weeks ago, and she calls it, like, she said, you know, you need somebody with a kind of helicopter view who can see what's happening, and who also can be, in her words, to be the grit in the system, so who can, because it's not necessarily easy to do, so you need somebody to kind of help, but also check, okay, is it actually working, what is working, what is not working, are people doing the things that they're supposed to be doing, so there's that accountability aspect. And then there's also an aspect in terms of that maybe that this commission is different from some of the other proposals, is that you know, it's very much in that long-term thinking and that future generations, which at the moment no organization in Scotland is doing. Like, in some ways there was a discussion in your report that you published yesterday about, you know, isn't that already the role of MSPs to do that championing and the advocacy? But I don't think future generations are represented by current MSPs very well, because obviously they're not electing you. So that's, I think, one of the big differences to some of the other proposals. And so the last point I want to make is that long-term, that has been really important in Wales, I think, is that long-term. Like, that commission has appointed for 7 years. That means, you know, local authorities, public bodies know where to go and who to talk to and build a relationship that will help them implement the, you know, the duties and the ways of working. Whereas if that is anywhere else, you have the risk that, you know, governments change, official, you know, civil servants change quite regularly. And actually, I think that, you know, having these personal relationships that the commissioner could build are actually probably not to be dismissed in that respect.
I think the argument can be made for a number of areas, you know, a whole plethora of commissioners, you know, having a specific relationship or having an overview of one specific area, but surely that's the role of MSPs, parliamentary committees, to scrutinise, backed with a huge number of civil servants and that we actually have. And it's more about emphasising the importance of, you know, the National Performance Framework within the Scottish Government to ensure it does get the appropriate the appropriate scrutiny, etc., that it requires. I mean, spending £1.5-2 million on an extra commissioner with all the back office, etc., is £1.5-2 million you're not going to be spending on, for example, frontline public services.
I think, if I can respond to that, I think there's a danger here. If, as I said, Max said, there are things we can do for free, but, you know, we are at a point where the National Performance Framework is just sitting at the side with, you know, not having been used very much, to actually changing the whole culture of how we work in Scotland to a point where, you know, this is aligned. That's not something that you can do without investment. So in one way or another, we're going to have to do the investment into the capacity building. And the idea that, and as I said, I think the best way to do it is through the commissioner, but the idea that by not doing a commissioner, you get it for free, I think is very dangerous. Like, at some, because at the moment we haven't got a body in Scotland who can do this capacity building, and I mean, and as I said, we can have a discussion about where else we can put it, but I think it's dangerous to think about, you know, that you can get it for free, but I think it's an investment that's very much worth it, in the sense that it will save money in other places. It will also save money in the long term in terms of, you know.
In case you wonder why I'm asking all the questions apart from Liz so far, it's because members aren't exactly tripping over themselves to indicate that they want to come in. So, but Liz will come in after me in just a minute. Just one more question from me then at the moment. Sarah, you've expressed concerns that the plethora of outcomes means it's quite hard for government to kind of align with them all, etc. Do you think that there should be fewer outcomes and greater focus on those? And if so, what should the priority outcomes be?
Yes, Max and I were talking about this earlier, and he was reminding me, I think there's some evidence that shows that most human beings are not capable of holding more than about seven things in their mind. And I worked in government with the national outcomes for a long time and couldn't remember what they all were. So if what we are asking is for all public bodies to understand the impact of, or the implications of those for their work, then asking them at the moment to hold 11, and I think it's up to 14 under the revised recommendations, I think is challenging. It's interesting that in Wales, the equivalent of the wellbeing outcomes, which are the wellbeing goals, are seven. And I also think that there's a risk, and I think this has happened almost by accident, but it has happened, that there are now so many that you can almost map them onto, you know, one or two directorates of the Scottish Government for each outcome. And of course, what that does is works against the ambition of these being outcomes that cohere people around them, because you almost end up creating new silos with these outcomes. So I think the reality is that the inevitably, if you ask lots of people, would you like to see your particular issue reflected in an outcome, then people say yes and more outcomes get created. But I think there is now a risk that there are so many that the challenge of using them to set a coherent long-term outcome is in fact greater rather than lesser.
Okay, Alice?
Just on that point, I think this is part of the reason why we needed the participative process that we didn't get, because when you ask lots of people in an online consultation, we got an expanded number of outcomes without any discussion about what that might actually mean and how we could maybe do it better, and this is how they do it in Wales. There was no discussion, it was just adding on. They're all important outcomes, but how you translate those specifics into maybe more higher level global outcomes, you know, that's something that requires discussion and participation.
Okay, going to open up the session now, and the first colleague to ask questions will be Jamie, to followed by Liz.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, Convener, I was just enjoying your questioning so too much. I suppose it's almost similar to the point Liz Smith has already made. I mean, you know, we're going to see over the next few years a tightening of budgets, a lack of sustainability in the public sector, perhaps, and some tough decisions made. Given that the concerns over what's been delivered or what's been followed so far, government now has a lot harder decisions to make. Are you suggesting that's going to be, I suppose, what confidence do you have that it's going to be easier or more likely them to follow some of the desired outcomes here? Or is this really going to be a kind of box-ticking exercise?
I think it may take that. So I think you rightly identify the risk. And again, the risk that short-term challenges, short-term budget pressures overtake a focus on long-term outcomes. But I would also argue that it's all the more important that a framework is used at a time like that, particularly picking up the points that Alison was making earlier about investment in prevention and disinvestment from things in order to shift the dial on inequalities and poverty. And the existence of a framework that can help people to act short-term but in the context of long-term outcomes, I would certainly say is arguably more important at the time of the pressures that there are at the moment. And Lucas's point earlier about understanding unintended consequences and trade-offs and being transparent about them, again, feels all the more important when resources are tighter than they have been in more recent years and difficult choices have to be made and explained.
I mean, I suppose that's the point. I mean, you know, I think you've all made a very good, case for why you believe this is important. I suppose, what evidence is there that the Scottish Government feel the same way?
So I would say that there's, with a few exceptions that we've already talked about, there's not a lot to argue with in the statement that the Government has made in its response to the consultation. I think the question that I and my colleagues here are raising is about the extent to which that actually reflects the priorities that exist across government and whether it will be used in that way. And if past action is an indication of future intent, then I think what we're saying is that we lack confidence that it will be used.
So in 5 years' time, we'll be back here and you'll be saying justifiably the same things, probably that it's important, the government need to look longer term, whatever government it happens to be, but they're not, and there needs to be a refocus on it, do you think?
I mean, this committee made some trenchant criticisms and, in my view, good recommendations when it conducted its inquiry into the NPF in 2022, and we are here in 2024 saying very similar things.
Okay.
I would say as well that it does, I mean, we're discussing a particular framework, a set of outcomes indicators, but I think it also kind of relates to the broader question of government decision making, which in a context of fiscal restraint, as Sarah's just talked about, it's ever more important to have a balanced and long-term view of strategy. And another thing this committee did was it ran an inquiry into government decision-making, effective government decision-making. And Professor Paul Kearney
when he was concluding his report as advisor to that committee. He said, what I'm struck by is when I read Scottish Government documents or accounts, they very much emphasise their aspirations, their structures, their strategies. They do not really emphasise the more fine-grained decisions or their impacts. It's a general story about how it's supposed to work. I would suggest that way, that means of decision-making, doesn't equip us particularly well to confront that new fiscal reality. So I think what we've seen through the decision-making process, again, you know, we can look at Wales, is we can provide that level of detail, that level of consistency, that level of policy coherence by taking what we've got seriously, our wellbeing framework, our performance framework, whatever you would like to call it. I think also when you look at the status of public service reform, which when we're talking about things like prevention amongst many others, and this was a key part of the programme for government, we can see a sort of half-formed ideas littered through the last 10 or 15 years, right? We had the Christie principles, which everyone loved, again, a very sort of galvanising force in Scottish public life, and the Auditor General, amongst many others, can find scant evidence of those principles being active parts of how we do public service reform. We had a Scottish approach about, what, 7, 8 years after that, perhaps. That seemed cobbled together, and now it's sort of not really discussed in any, you know, cohesive manner. There's an opportunity to link all of that together and sort of re-galvanise a consistent approach to public service reform with the NPF as the sort of the kind of headline act in that. But what we don't see then is the sort of opportunity to do that. So where are our ways of working? Well, they're the Christie principles, but they're very separate to the NPF. So there's much more that we could do just in terms of being strategic, and the NPF is a device that helps us to do that.
Dr. Hattie.
Yeah, I think, I mean, it's one thing I've always said about the NPF is it's got amazing transformational potential, mm-hmm. and we aren't using that potential. And there are many things, simple things, more complex things that we could do to enhance that. I won't shy away, the Commission has always put forward that the connections in terms of the human rights basis to the framework are really, they could be really solid. They are there, but they're not tapped into. Another disappearing commitment at the moment we're seeing, was no mention this year of the Human Rights Bill in the programme for government, along with the national outcomes. And the Human Rights Bill has got the potential there to link the NPF with legal obligations. And I think that is something that we're shying away from, and it's the accountability bit again. It's coming back to that link with accountability. Putting more structure around how we deliver on the NPF puts a spotlight on accountability. And I just get the feeling that that's where the commitment is missing. And there are so many areas and the report, you know, excellent ideas around how we can improve accountability. And I think that's where the focus, this implementation and accountability, is the focus for the next stage.
Okay. Look, if you've got anything to add to that.
Just very briefly, I agree with that. I think for me, yeah, as I said, it's just very frustrating because the pieces of the puzzle are there, as Max said, with Christie, with the NPF, with the Community Empowerment Act. We're just not putting them together. And I think really that was the idea behind the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill, which now the government has not included in its programme for government, but Sarah Boyack's members' bill is there. And so I guess in response to your question, what the commitment of the government is at the moment, it doesn't look particularly strong, but there is an opportunity for Parliament to say, actually, this is important to us. You better get your act together. And I think that's really what Sarah Boyack's members' bill could do.
Okay, so I mean, I'm getting not a huge amount of confidence that the Scottish Government are really committed to this, or committed to this in delivering on the outcomes. They're obviously updating, but then is there much point updating something they're not going to follow anyway, in principle? But I'll maybe hand back to Convener.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Jamie. A list to be followed by Michael.
Yeah, can I just pursue this issue about why, when it was first introduced, there seemed to be very considerable commitment to it, and it was mentioned in different documents. And I can remember, I think it was 2 years ago, our away day when we were speaking to Dundee councillors and people who worked in various local authorities who were very keen on it, and they were making quite a strong link about what they deliver in a local authority to the National Performance Framework. What do you think it is that has happened to sort of slide it away from people's interest? What's happened in there to take it from being very prominent into not really being mentioned at all?
So I think there's probably a number of answers to that question. So I'll speak to one, and others may have other things to say. So I would say that not even just in more recent years, but from the introduction of the National Performance Framework right back in 2007, I recognise it's gone through a number of iterations since then. Mm-hmm. The implementation of it has relied very heavily on what Max terms soft power, soft levers. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the work that was done was to build relationships, and that's really important. Was to do training and build people's understanding of what it takes to deliver long-term outcomes. In the early years, particularly, it was talked about a lot. People were brought together in the Scottish Leaders Forum, for example, and it was very present. It felt very present. And over time, there has been quite a lot of change of personnel. I mean, that's part of it. Different people choose maybe to emphasise different things, to talk about different things. And there's no doubt that within the most recent period of years within government, there has been a very strong emphasis on the delivery of individual services or individual commitments. Now, to be really clear, delivery of commitments matters, yeah. Improvement of services matters. But I think sometimes there is a tendency to talk and act as though the delivery of individual things, successful or not, is separate from an ambition to achieve a long-term outcome. So you're almost either in the outcomes camp or you're in the delivery camp. Okay. And I think that has been very unhelpful for the prominence and presence of the National Performance Framework.
Do you think that is true in local government as well as in national government?
Local government obviously takes its cue from national government in some respects. The squeeze on local authority budgets in more recent years has required many local authorities to focus on statutory obligations for reasons that one can understand. And I've heard local authorities say that means that the space for the space and energy and resource for the conversation about long-term sustainability, and particularly about investing in preventative measures as opposed to dealing with the wounds that are bleeding right now, is constrained. But I also hear local authorities and people working in COSLA saying that there is less of a dialogue with government about what role different actors in the system have to play. And I would certainly say that has become more pronounced in recent years.
Yeah, and presumably that relationship has to be mended if we're going to move forward. Yep.
Yeah. And I think it's worth noting, and I think it was in the Clark's note, that the Scottish Leaders Forum responds to the consultation itself. Yeah. And I think it's worth reminding us who the Scottish Leaders Forum are. They are the senior executive leaders across health, local government, Scottish government and Scottish public bodies. And they themselves note that the current system of accountability does nothing to promote national outcomes, that procedural, political, budget and audit makes little use of them. So if that's what the executive leadership group are saying, then I think that's interesting and tells us quite a lot.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Michael, to follow by Michelle.
I suppose I see the purpose of this whole process as about breaking the short-termism of politics, so trying to put things in longer cycles. And as a result, probably we've heard quite a lot of talking about the technocratic bureaucracy, about setting targets and trying to bring the state behind a certain set of goals, which I understand. But inherently, these are political questions. So the reason that this isn't working or isn't happening, we've just taken evidence in the previous session from Oxfam, who said it's just not working at all, it doesn't work, is because there's no political commitment to making it work. Is that not right?
I think it's a risk. I think when we look at Northern Ireland, Wales, Scotland, I think the other two devolved nations have taken a risk. So Northern Ireland took a risk when it made its senior civil servants directly accountable, or it tried to before its government collapsed, accountable for outcomes. So it said, here's your outcome, expect to be held to account by ministerial oversight or parliamentary scrutiny. We didn't go that route. for some valid reasons, that's not the right way to embed outcomes in government, I don't believe. But it took a risk in doing that. It subjected itself to scrutiny. Wales took a risk when it set up a Future Generations Commissioner. So the leadership and the championing was out with government. It wasn't a government that was optionally embodying its performance framework. It was, if you go about your transport strategy in a way that we deem to be inconsistent with your stated wellbeing goals, there's going to be a knock at the door and, hey, we've got review powers to get some leverage. So Scotland hasn't really followed suit in that its NPF, its sort of national goals, national objectives, have been sort of stewarded by government. And I think, you know, this committee has spent a great deal of time, and all of us contributing evidence in scrutinising that state of affairs. So I would wonder if now is the time to consider whether the Scottish Government is the effective custodian of the NPF, and whether it's possible really to implement a wellbeing framework and a set of national outcomes solely from within government.
Alison.
Yeah, I think that ties nicely back to the issue of where it started and where it maybe went wrong or lost its way. And it started off very much as a performance framework for government. And then the next iteration, there was very much a big emphasis, rightly, that it was moving to be Scotland's goals and not just the government. And the link between, therefore, whose responsibility was it to deliver seemed to dilute. And I think that, for me, is where the kind of that contributory theory of change is really helpful to understand. Government has a role, local authorities have a role, public bodies have a role, business, civil society. Everybody has a role and a role to play in delivery. But we need to know also what the government's role is. They need to set out their stall in terms of, this is what we say we are delivering towards those outcomes, so they can be held accountable for that. I think that's where there's a gap.
I think that's really useful. I mean, there's also a question here, though, to me about the political coherence of the goals. So, you know, as much as we have had one governing party in Scotland for 17 years, I don't think anybody would dispute that we have had a variety of different approaches and, frankly, core beliefs within that. Some people in government who don't believe that economic growth is a positive thing at all, other people thinking that it is the only thing that matters. You know, we have people from the original administration that was elected in 2007 who set this out, who are now First Minister, but others who are saying that Scotland's an effective third world nation in the press. So it's how can you put together a long-term process under one government if that government departs so radically in terms of its understanding about the organising principles of its purpose?
So part of the answer to that is as Alison has suggested, is both a really good engaged process that arrives at the set of national outcomes, so they don't feel like the government's outcomes, and indeed these aren't. This is in legislation. These are Scotland's outcomes, or certainly have been agreed by the Parliament as a whole, but also the ownership of them, so that the government isn't both setting the homework and marking the homework, and that's part of the problem at the moment. I think going back to your original question as well, public administration is not necessarily sets everyone's boat on fire. I think it's really encouraging that this committee, as I've said before, has that responsibility, because public administration is an incredibly important part of the overall picture of how outcomes are or are not achieved in Scotland. And therefore, it is incumbent upon public bodies, including government, at an administrative level, to build the capacity to do things well and do them well. But absent political leadership, it's really hard to go on doing that. So there's an interesting alchemy almost between what the administration has to deliver, doing its job well, and the political leadership that is set to incentivise that delivery. And I think when the two of them are in alignment, as we perhaps have seen in Wales in recent years, that's where you can make most progress.
But we have had, in comparative terms, stable government in Wales for that long period of time as well. Yeah. So one party, again, in government, but with an ideological coherence across that period, which hasn't been the case here. And can I ask, my last question on this then was probably about the if everything's a priority, nothing's a priority, in essence. I think some of the commentary about how, in essence, bland these are. Is it not better to have these technocratic goals set in the non-contestable space? So things that we know, climate change is happening, adaptation has to occur. You know, we have to transition around. There are no voices in Parliament that don't agree with these things. I understand there are voices on the fringes of politics who disagree, but in the core, it's non-contestable. But some of the issues, I think, that are within these, around, particularly around the role of economic growth and whether we should have a well-being approach versus something that's driven around GDP, is clearly a contested space around the Cabinet table, let alone within the Parliament. So how can you have a long-term goal that's based on an ideological frame that the Deputy First Minister and members of our Cabinet, the First Minister, it would seem, don't agree on themselves?
I don't think the only party that's had ideological conflicts, given they went from Corbynism to Starmerism in the space of the last three years.
To be fair, Convener, though, that we were not in power at that time. I think it's a recognisable point.
Wales,
we were talking about the operation of this framework in Scotland under the government. So how, please, Lucas.
Yeah, I think it raises a good point, and I think that goes back to Sarah's and Max's point, that in how far is it, you know, I think there's a problem with the framework if the consultation process is so weak that it's essentially the government setting the goals, which is kind of, in some ways, where we got to a little bit with this consultation. And I think the economy one is a very interesting one. Like, I think the question about growth or not, it's not for today. That's about means to an end. This is not about the ends. And so, in some ways, actually, and that might be surprising to come from me, it's like, obviously, we were very happy to see the well-being economy terminology in the goal. But also, I was very worried about it because it basically means it was just a thing that was popular with that government at the time. And it was not something that has come from society, from the bottom up, saying, like, this is what we want to see. And we can see what that happens now. Now, you know, it's like it's in there, but it hasn't got the legitimacy that it could have. And then that questions the legitimacy of the whole framework. So the whole point of it is something, actually, here's something we're trying to create, something to find a common ground. What do we agree on in terms of long-term goals? Because I think without that, we won't be able to move forward as a society. Okay. And
thank you, Lucas.
Okay. Thank you. Michelle, to follow by Ross.
Good morning. What a great discussion so far. I'm really enjoying your contribution. Just picking up on a few points, Michael made an interesting, or came up with an interesting phrase, ideological adherence, which I'm sure we could debate. But it does beg a question for me in terms of accountability versus responsibility in a devolved setting. Now, I fully accept what you're saying about Wales, but I think we all recognise they're fairly early on in our journey, and that's the case with Northern Ireland. But in this sort of strange sort of setup, what challenge do you see from the difference between accountability and responsibility? Max, you're nodding, so you have to go first.
it's a great question. I hesitate to deviate from the accountability point because I think we've been trucking with responsibility for a long, long while in Scotland. And that, I think, has allowed us to dodge the question of who should be accountable for what by when. I'm in, you know, under no delusion that holding people directly to responsible for an outcome or an indicator is the wrong approach. But I think there are now real ways that you can structure accountability relationships that make people feel accountable for these national goals, these national indicators, but don't embody a really simplistic logic of direct accountability for movement in national indicators. Mm-hmm. Much more about the contribution that people are encouraged to make, and then holding a public body, for instance, to account for that stated contribution, and taking the whole context into account. Now, that's laborious work, But it's real accountability. It's not, feeding the beast, performance reporting. It's about enabling and then holding people to account for stretching contributions to our spectrum of national outcomes. That's the way that we should be engaging with accountability. So we can all feel responsible, but I think we also have to be accountable.
Yeah. I mean, you touch on a culture of delivery, but I'm interested in commentary from anybody else as well.
Yeah, I think as well it's important. It's an important route to mending relationships and developing relationships between national and local government. There's a tendency, certainly from local governments we've spoken to have a feeling that it's national priorities put down on local authorities to deliver on with no resources, instead of looking at what are the local priorities. And that's a discussion that hasn't happened this time, looking at the national outcomes and what do they mean at the local level, and in terms of developing relevant indicators for measuring progress, not just setting national level indicators, but actually what's relevant at the local level for delivering on one outcome might be different from one area to another. And so allowing that ability for local authorities to look at where and how they can be held accountable will be different from what maybe the national level should be. So I think that there's a big dialogue to be had, and for me that still goes back to that lack of dialogue in developing the outcomes. And the outcomes and the indicators are two separate processes, and they really should be part of the same discussion, because how you measure, what's important, you measure what you treasure, and unless that's part of the discussion of setting out the outcomes, we lose that ability to develop accountability from the ground up.
Mm-hmm. And adding on to that, I know you want to come in, Sarah, in terms of alignment at an even bigger picture to the SDGs, which is an area that we haven't touched on yet. So I know you want to answer my first question, but perhaps reflect on that as well.
Yes, and in a way you could pull this together. I suppose one of the interesting things about the SDGs is that what in the Scottish context is that, as the government's report says, there's a suggestion that alignment with the SDGs is in itself a good thing. And of course, alignment is only a good thing if it's meaningful. And in the same way, going back to what Alison was saying about other public bodies or local authorities, if local authorities simply can, or anyone else, can simply demonstrate that they are aligning their policies to the NPF, well, that's another version of the tick box exercise. And that's, again, where I think this question of what a much more sophisticated accountability environment looks like is really interesting, because the issues that everybody is dealing with are complex and sophisticated, and therefore I don't think we should shy away from a much more sophisticated and complex way of thinking about what accountability needs to look like. So, for example, I think it would be interesting to talk to leaders about what it would feel like to be held accountable for creating the conditions for people in their organisations to collaborate better, or to understand what long-term trends are and how they apply those in their organisation. Now, those are not things that you just give a tick, yes or no. They're things where interesting conversations that build relationships start. And as I say, the Auditor General has started to get a little bit more into that territory, but doesn't have formal powers for auditing that. So where that question of what do people feel responsible for making happen, and how does that align to where their hard accountability sit, feels to be absolutely the germane one for this conversation.
And before I bring in Lucas, that sounds like much more of a pivot and a focus on outcomes rather than just these measures that we've talked about. Okay, yeah. Lucas, anything final to add?
Just to echo Sarah, I think that's where these ways of working come in, which are really important in ways, and we talk a lot about their goals, but actually I would say probably the ways of working are just as important. So they've basically got, I think they've got four. Is that right?
Five.
Okay, sorry. But basically, that's the thing, and they're in the legislation as well. So they're not only accountable for the outcomes; they're also accountable for how they go about achieving them. Because there's a recognition that this is complex. So sometimes the best you can do and measure is, how you do things, rather than what impact they're going to have in 20 or 30 years' time. But there's an assumption if you go about it this way, it's more likely to create better outcomes further down the line.
And just last kind of quick fire question, just to make sure we've bottomed out a thread that a few people have been asking about. In just a one word answer is fine. In your opinion, do you genuinely see a demonstrable appetite for this work from government?
hadn't finished that sentence. I think it's patchy and mixed, isn't it? I think everyone shares the aspiration. I think that we probably differ on our anticipation of how it will be used. And I think there's different levels of appetite on that point, certainly politically. I think really one of the interesting ways to look at that question is to look beyond government and see the level of appetite for the MPF that has emerged entirely organically and without really any significant urging by the Scottish government. I mean, if you look at the work in the third sector and the level of attention that it's given there, now obviously that's one area of society. There's been very little from the business community. But it speaks to, I think, a general level of support that could be built on and enhanced and harnessed a lot more than it has. Compare that to the level of, I suppose, obscurity in which the Scottish Government has given to to how it's used the MPF. Mm-hmm. So I would be tempted to ignore the last point.
Obscurity, I think that says a lot.
Well, I'll say that the last couple of meetings we've had with government and their kind of expert advisory group around the MPF, it has been encouraging. They were very sceptical coming into some of the work, but they're really, the MPF team has been doing an awful lot of very good work. But that MPF team has changed about eight times since I started working on the MPF. I think it was about 2011-12 when I first started to really engage with it. And you really feel you're getting somewhere and there's some real good understanding of what it is and what it's driving for. And then the team changes and it all starts again. There's no consistency. And when you've got that lack of consistency of who's driving the process from below, it makes it really difficult then to get that buy-in elsewhere in government. I have concerns about current leadership. I think there's the agenda of well-being. It's so important. And the connection with rights is so important. And I feel you just get that feeling that there is not the willingness to put that at the forefront of how we develop policy. But I think in terms of, there was just coming back to a point that Lucas had made before, in terms of looking at what drives the change and the outcomes as well as an area that we've done a lot of work on rights-based outcomes and rights-based indicators. And I think I've brought this up in every submission I've done on the MPF. Instead of just looking at the results and looking at what we're trying to achieve, it helps you look at what structures you have in place. Are they the right ones? Have we got the right laws in place and policies? And are we delivering on those? Are we implementing those policies? Are we funding them properly to then see what the outcomes are? And it helps you then make the connections when the outcomes aren't what we expect. Is it because we've got the wrong policies or because they're not funded properly? Mm. Or is it, you know, so it makes those connections. Mm-hmm. It allows you to look backwards and forwards and not just at the results at the other end. So I think that that is a gap. And I know that everyone pushes back against having even more indicators than the ones that we already have. But it's maybe different types and it's a matrix of indicators rather than just looking at, you know, we'll have four for this outcome and four for that outcome. And they don't talk to each other. There needs to be that intersectionality that was mentioned before around what the outcomes are trying to achieve so that they're not siloed.
Mm-hmm. So maybe... I know. So given that additional complexity introduced by Alison, I think my question about do you genuinely see an appetite is even more moot.
Yeah. So government is in many ways a multi-headed beast, and I would absolutely endorse Alison's comment about the small team that looks after this, both the chopping and changing and also the degree of commitment that they hold. I think it's interesting that in some of the parts of government that are maybe further from the centre where this is more... where this is given greater regard. So I know you had Michael Kellett here from Public Health Scotland earlier, and Public Health Scotland is an example of a body which absolutely sees how this could and should drive their work and the work of government more generally. So when I talk to Public Health Scotland, they start with the outcomes of the National Performance Framework, and that's partly because they are so impelled by the relationship between all the different parts of government and good health outcomes. So I think the rest of government could learn a lot from what's happening there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly before I go on to the question that I was going to ask, Alison, just on the comment you made there about that sense of a lack of appetite or perhaps a bit of rolling back from government on principles around wellbeing economy, was that a reflection on
the government right now, as in the administration of the last 6 months, or is that a wider reflection?
The last couple, I think, to be fair, we had for a number of years a very strong commitment to developing human rights legislation and the importance of human rights and the SDGs and wellbeing. That was all very current in the work that we were doing, and I felt in lots of work I was doing, I was constantly referring to where the national outcomes reflected and things that we were doing and the SDGs. That, I just feel, has disappeared over the last 3 or 4 years. And I think you are going to have changes in priorities and changes in ideology. What will come with change in personnel, it just leaves a concern, because there are strong commitments and manifesto commitments that we're now seeing disappear.
Thanks very much. And the other point that I was looking to pick up on, I think Sarah said it most recently, but everybody's mentioned it at one point around the danger of just a tick box exercise. And I suppose I'm wondering if a tick box exercise would at least be better than where we are now, because at the start of the session, Max listed various government strategy policy documents that have been published recently without so much as even a tick box reference to MPF. And as much as I accept that, you know, the ideal situation would be something more like in Wales, where this is really deeply culturally embedded in government, if we at least took some mechanistic approaches that we don't take now, it would move us a little bit further on. You know, the Scottish Government has handbooks and protocols when it comes to the drafting of bills, for example. I find it hard to see how it wouldn't be possible to say, for example, if a strategy document is significant enough that it needs ministerial sign-off, that the protocol for that includes, yeah, it would be a mechanistic exercise, but it includes a requirement that the relevant MPF outcomes are referenced. Given where we are now and the fact that we're not even doing that, would that mechanistic approach not at least be progress?
There's something to be said for visibility here. I think, you know, if you were to scrutinise the government on that, and it's a good job no one does, then they wouldn't come out of it looking like a particularly joined up sort of cohesive policy maker. There's something to be said for branding in that context, and that this is the way that we do business in Scotland. There's an OECD conference coming up next month on wellbeing in government. Now, 5 years ago, Scotland would have been seen probably as one of the forerunners in that, and you would expect to have a lot of work celebrated. But now it feels like Scotland is a bit player in that broad international movement. 2/3 of OECD countries now have wellbeing frameworks. If you were to rank them in terms of integration, Scotland, you know, whatever standard you would use, probably wouldn't do particularly well. There's something about, if this is the stated way that we do government, and it's not visible, it sort of reflects badly on the broader decision-making and strategic competency of the government. So, you know, we're losing influence with this lack of an integrated approach. It should be, you know, that at that conference, Scotland is front and centre, and on all the international delegates, you know, sort of lists of things to learn about, but not so. So I think for that reason, I absolutely agree that a tick box exercise is better than the sort of patchy and piecemeal and ad hoc situation we've got.
And so I would agree with all of that. Of course, as always with these things, what it is that you're ticking is relevant. And I think as Max illustrates in his report, what we've found and experienced is it's relatively easy to name check the national outcomes, although even that is not done as it might be. To have to tick a box and demonstrate that your policy or legislative proposal was developed through the lens of the national outcomes, and to argue the case for that, it is a different thing. And if there were going to be boxes to be ticked, I would far rather see people being asked to tick that more sophisticated box than just the yes-no.
Thanks.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think that's exactly the point. And I think when the budgetary documents over the last few years have tried to improve the connection with national outcomes, it is the simpler one that's there just now, where we just name the national outcomes or the human rights that might be relevant to those particular budget areas, but there doesn't have a feeling, or there's no confidence that there's a real understanding that why I put that one in that box, when it's quite clear that there are some that are missing, you know, really obvious ones that are missing. So I think it's the capacity building, the understanding that has to come with that to make it a process that's worth doing.
Thank you. Lucas?
Just briefly to build on that, I think there's also a question about, you know, one of the reasons people get a bit resentful with tick box exercises, because there's quite a lot of them already. And I'm not an expert on exactly who has to tick which boxes, but I would imagine that part of the point of the NPF is to streamline that a bit. So if you could, you know, use that approach to kind of, you know, embed it more widely and to maybe kind of streamline, align some of the bit that is already going on, then that would be quite helpful. But I don't know whether anybody has looked into that in more detail.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay, well, thank you very much. That's exhausted questions from the committee. I'll just get one further one to Lucas, really, but others can contribute if they want. And you've talked about one of the issues of the national outcomes is it's got the potential to reduce inequalities. But you've said that by splitting inequality across different outcomes, there is a risk of inequality not being given the prominence it deserves.
I think, in some sense, I think in the revised outcomes, they have inequality now in one of the outcomes that's now mentioned in the title. So that's very good. But as again, I think inequality, I should maybe say, is something I think that is embedded in all of the outcomes or is related to all of the outcomes. But in order for that to work, you really have to make sure that it then is embedded in all of the other outcomes. And I think, you know, the Human Rights Commission made some really good points on that. In that, also related to the indicators, is that, you know, if you're like interested in gender inequality, is one of the big ones that hasn't got a specific, like in the SDGs, it's got its own indicator, I think, its own outcome, not in the National Performance Framework. But that means you need to be able to be clear about how that feeds into all the other outcomes. And you also need to have the indicators that are, like, you know, segregated by gender and by different, so that you can check these outcomes. So I think that was mainly saying that, there's a risk that if you just put inequality into all of them, that it disappears. But it also needs to be there. So that was my point.
Alison?
I completely follow up on that. I agree with Lucas that the issue we had with human rights and equality, that there was debates just before the last outcome set was released at the very last minute about whether or not human rights should be mainstreamed across, like equality was in the purpose statement or the value statement, and not an outcome in and of itself. And we argued really strongly, and we still do, that yes, in an ideal world, human rights and equality would permeate the entire outcome set without the need for an individual outcome. But we can't mainstream what we don't understand, and we've had 25 years of equality and we still don't get it properly. And I think we need, therefore, the vertical column and the horizontal throughout the national outcomes. But the entire human rights framework underpins the national outcomes. That is not apparent at all in the narrative that sits alongside the performance framework at the moment. And when we talk about capacity building in government, one of the areas now in development in relation to the Human Rights Bill is going to need a lot of capacity building. And this is a perfect opportunity to bring those things together, to bring that understanding together, to see where the connections are that will link the outcomes, that links the rights, that inequality also has that role right the way across. Every single outcome will be able to be measured depending on the data and the availability of disaggregated data to look really in depth at whether or not we're delivering on that. But equality and human rights should feature in throughout the outcome set, but also a really strong focus on that, on delivering on that outcome in itself.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, just before we wind up, does any member of the panel wish to make any final points today?
Convener, one thing I would want to just reiterate is the fact that since the government published their report on the NPF consultation, the decision has been made not to include the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill in the programme for government, and therefore we should assume that the government is not going to bring forward that legislation in the course of this Parliament. And therefore, all the issues which were raised within the consultation on the NPF about accountability and about duties and about ways of working are not going to be resolved through that mechanism. And as Lucas has already mentioned, Sarah Boyack has a members' bill in development in relation to that. And we as an organisation, and I'm sure my colleagues here go on being interested in the range of ways in which these accountabilities and duties could be brought to bear, because our collective view is that without something like that, it's going to be very hard to make the National Performance Framework, whatever we call it, meaningful.
Hey, Max?
I would agree with that, and I would also revisit, I suppose, some of the other recommendations that this committee made to the Scottish Government that they responded favourably to, including the publication of an implementation plan, which has chopped and changed in terms of, you know, its leadership within the government, and I think that document seems to be primary importance now with the recall of those legislative options. So I think, you know, if we could get clarity on what the Scottish Government tends to do with that implementation plan and how it tends to govern that process, that plan as a continuous improvement process that provides a way to feed into what the government does around implementation, that would seem to me to be particularly critical in the current situation.
Okay, thank you, Alison.
Yep, what they both said, I think, in terms also with the Programme for Government not mentioning the Human Rights Bill, we feel similarly in relation to that another layer of accountability for this has been potentially missed. The implementation plan is going to be critical in whether or not the NPF delivers what we hope it will. I also don't want the NPF to lose its focus on the SDGs and the whole agenda. We are just over 5 years away from 2030, nowhere near delivering on the Sustainable Development Goals. There will be another set that follow from the Sustainable Development Goals. And Scotland, you know, it really took the bull by the horns when the goals came out and made very strong commitments as a country as to what we should be doing to deliver on the SDGs. And I would like to see Scotland back in that room discussing what we're going to do when the next comes. And that should be tied into our national outcomes. So I don't want to lose that as part of the discussion, because the SDGs hasn't had much of a mention here today.
Thank you. That's why I always give you something to wind up with, so that you can always fill in the gaps in our questioning. Lucas?
Yeah, I think I just want to end on emphasising again what Max says about that. You know, it really feels very frustrating that this is an agenda, both in wellbeing frameworks, in terms of future generations thinking, that the world is really moving on and developing. We've got the UN Summit for the Future coming up in a few days' time. And this is really something. And Scotland used to be a leader on this, and now we're kind of at the moment where everybody else is starting to develop this, we're kind of turning away, and it's just, I think, very frustrating. And just to be maybe explicit about that for us, that link between the wellbeing framework and the future generations thinking is absolutely crucial, in the sense that, you know, there's no point thinking about wellbeing outcomes if we're not thinking about how we can make sure that we can meet them for, you know, in 50 years' time or in 100 years' time. And that's why, you know, these two things are very much linked up in our head. And that's why one of the tables I always found a bit funny in the report that you published yesterday from SPICE is that, you know, the Future Generations Commissioner and the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Commissioner is listed separately, whereas I think anybody who's seriously thought about this has never sworn these as two separate things. Like, that was always the same kind of commissioner. So that was just something I wanted to mention.
Okay, well, thank you very much. A number of these issues that you've raised today, we will put obviously directly to the Scottish Government in the weeks ahead. I'd like to thank you all for your contributions today and for your excellent submissions. We'll now move into private session to discuss a contingent liability and a work programme, so I'll call a 2-minute break to allow our witnesses and the official report of broadcasting to leave.